welcome to the November 18th, is that what it is? Mm-hmm. Meeting the CPC. We have an ambitious agenda tonight and lots to do. The first order of business is to have public comment for those not commenting on specific projects in the basket of comment. Is there any folks out there? Public comment? No? Then moving right along to approval of the minutes for the October 21st meeting.
Is there a minute? October 21st.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? All opposed?
No, I'm just like.
No? All good? Excellent. Well, believe it or not, the chair actually has a chair's report tonight. I will be brief. We have good news, and bad news. The first bit of good news is look around and what is different. Screens, yay! They don't work, but we're getting there. So Sarah is reasonably ecstatic, is that right?
I'll be happy to
make up. Happy to threat of electrocution and those kinds of things. So that's the first good news. The second good news, as I'm hoping folks check their email, and we'll talk more about it when we get to our final decisions on our round, is that the state actually gave us more money than we even anticipated, $379,000. So that's really quite exciting. I think we're fortunate to live in a community that is funding at the maximum level, and we reap the benefits from the state. So that's really nice. Quite exciting. The bad news is this. We are losing two of our long-standing members. Tonight is their final swan song. So we're sad for both Marlene and David to be moving on to whatever they're moving on to. And we hope to see them in the crowd.
I think we're sad for ourselves. I think
we're
not sad for them.
No, we are sad for ourselves. You're absolutely right.
And just to say thank you for your many years of service.
Oh.
You get a
thank you.
Which makes a really cool paperweight, but I haven't figured
out
another
great story. So a round of applause. And we hope to see you in the crowd making public comments.
Yeah. If we did not pass the small grant conversation, they would have to stay.
That's true. That's true. We could not accept their retirement. So that's the bad news. But the good news is out with the old and in with the new. We'll be joined in January by three new people. Two are elected, actually one elected, one write-in, but that's being elected. So two new folks from the November ballot, as well as the woman replacing Glenn, whose name I cannot remember. Sarah, do we remember her name? From the rec department. She said
Julia. Julia Shabon.
So two out and three in to bring us up to a full committee. I am noticing that, David, your term expires in January. It's January 15th, never mind. I expire in January.
Yeah, sure.
So I don't quite know what that means. It may mean that if the city council fails to appoint me, you will be in need of somebody else. So I am happy to serve another term, but that requires the city council to do so.
Sarah, how would that be done?
Brian would have to contact someone on the city council.
And my city councilor is retiring, but
you could do that before the end.
Yeah, so I would attempt to do that. Devin, you expire in March. So
fine time.
Yeah, right? Midway through the cycle, so I'm not quite sure.
Well, so if you do that process through your city council, I should be a councilor, I should do it through mine?
No, you are the planning board rep.
Oh, right.
So you'd have to go through planning board.
Okay.
And aren't you the chair of planning board? Oh, there you go. Relatively paid, but I hereby appoint myself. And everybody else goes a while. Tony, 18. Linda, 2017. Jack, 2030-something.
Just got here.
So, so we'll hopefully figure that out and have a smooth transition. But the two of you will be missed. Thank you for your service. The next item on the agenda is the request by Grove Food Northampton to have a one-year extension from the grant. And I believe we have a representative from Grove Food there. We're lacking a podium. Should we move the podium? Is that more sense, does it? Where you can nest your stuff or your home. So you could tell us who you are and thank you.
Yes, I'm Clint Clay, Executive Director of Grove Food Northampton. I believe I was last year in January or February. So thank you for having me. Unfortunately, I'm here with a request I just really didn't want to make, and that is to extend our 2011 grant for one more year. And I, did you all get the letter that I sent a few weeks ago? Okay. So unfortunately, we our best efforts to spend that money down on two structures, which would have been really the primary uses of that money for this year, were thwarted by the Department of Agricultural Resources discovering that they had some issues, sort of legal issues that they wanted to resolve before they'll consider our certificate of approval application for those buildings. And as you probably know, on APR land, you need a certificate of approval for any non-temporary structure, even if it's agricultural. So we submitted in August a proposal to build the additional shed and pavilion that we had been planning on, that were anticipated, I think, back in our 2014 report when we talked about what we would be spending the rest of the money on in 2015. And we have designs. I have, I sort of gave up on you after 7 copies, but you might have to share a little. But I do have copies of the design, what we intended to build, and then I'll pass around a letter that I received recently from the Department of Ag Resources. But the bottom line is that for reasons unrelated to the buildings that we proposed, the Department of Agriculture is saying that they need time to resolve some issues related to the 198-year lease between the city and Grove Food Northampton on 17 acres, including where the community garden resides. And this results from changes to the statute governing the APR program, changes in the legal counsel representing the Department of Ag Resources, and sort of a desire on their part to clean house and make things consistent. And so, you know, essentially they're saying, we wish we had looked at this differently 4.5 years ago, but since we didn't, we're going to make your life difficult until we figure out how to paper it over. And so what that has meant for me is that I had to delay construction, and because winter's coming, and I don't know when we'll get this resolved. So I did ask them to put something on paper, because we'd had many, many phone conversations and in-person meetings. And so the letter that's going around is sort of their not particularly helpful letter saying, we can't really consider your application right now. And so that's sort of where we stand. And so my hope is that the committee would be willing to give us another year of to sort this out and then spend the grant money. I certainly hope on the same proposed construction projects next year. Obviously, if we're not successful in getting certificates of approval, then we would be looking at some non-permanent, temporary structure alternatives, other ways to achieve some of the same goals and other related goals from our original 2011 application under the grant. But we want to give this the best shot, and I'm reasonably confident that we will resolve it. It just taking time if they don't move too quickly. So I think that's about all I have to say unless I have, anyone has questions I can answer.
How much of the money is unspent at this point?
I don't have a, Sarah, you might have a current number, but it's 34, around 34,000. I have a couple of bills, like the engineers work on getting the building permit for this, that I haven't yet submitted for reimbursement because I was trying to see where this was all headed.
The initial grant was $104,500, and there's $36,138.78.
Okay, and that was the number at the beginning of this year, is that right?
That's through June, which is the last thing.
Oh, okay, all right, a little bit more than I was saying. But we have, as I said, a few expenses, but we really, because this was a big project and we wanted to make sure we had enough money to cover it, we really held off on any other expenses under the grant for the last 6 months.
So will your permit expire? Do you have to go through permitting again?
I've talked to the building commissioner and they said I just need to write them a letter and they'll give me at least another 180 days. So I'm not too worried about that. If the money's extended, it's really just a formality on there.
Have you sensed anywhere along the way that this might just not happen?
Well,
I mean, losing the file is pretty disheartening.
Losing the file was pretty disheartening, and the fact that there's new legal counsel at the department and a real effort to, they've essentially brought, these decisions used to be made by the Agricultural Land Preservation Committee, the same committee that voted on APR funding. And that committee had its own problems, but it was also, they were willing to understand circumstances could be different in different situations. And in this case, I think what's happening is an effort, as I said, to make things more consistent so that they don't run into some of the precedent-setting issues that cause them some trouble, all of which I fully understand, but I can't really go back in time and make things more consistent if you didn't make it consistent at the time. And they were fully aware of the lease of the city and the community gardens and all that before growth was entered and purchased the land. So it is quite frustrating, and I guess my answer is I am fairly confident that we will resolve it, but given how difficult the conversations have been so far, to even just get them to say what their problem is over the last almost 3 months, I'm a little nervous that they may drag it out and not give us a real path to resolution. Because really what we need is a clear statement of their objections and how we would proceed down a path to resolve them. And we just haven't quite gotten there despite many attempts on my part. Yeah.
Can you elaborate at all on what the issue is? Is it an issue with this use with these pavilions and sheds being consistent with your lease, or is it something that underlies the actual use?
Yeah, it's a little, it's more underlying, and I don't know if you have time, but I'm happy to sort of take 2 or 3 minutes to try to explain it.
Maybe I can give you some context for my question. That we've obviously sunk a lot of funds into Florence Field as a city and into the community garden, and so if the issue is one that suggests that there's an issue with the longevity of that commitment, or that we won't be able to carry out what we intended when we gave that money, that would be a larger issue. If it's simply an inconsistency with what's allowed and not allowed use, that might be different.
Yeah, so I think that in the end, it will get worked out and it won't turn out to be as big a deal as it sounds. But just to be completely open about it, the issue that they're looking at is that the length of the lease, which they knew up front, 198 years, and we also have a 99-year lease with Crimson and Clover Farm, according to some case law, constitutes a transfer of ownership. And their argument now, it's not their argument 4.5 years ago when we asked them to say that this was okay and bless the idea of the community gardens all, which we have a paper trail on. Their current argument seems to be, well, for a lease that long, you should have come to us to ask us to subdivide the APR into the 17-acre south parcel and the remaining 104 acres. And if you had come and asked us to do that and we had granted that subdivision, of the APR into two separate APRs, then 7 acres of community garden out of a 17-acre APR might have been too much. We might not have said okay to it. 7 out of 121, they were fine with, and there's, again, plenty of paper trails showing that. So essentially, they need to figure out, because this is, as I said, applying their current standard for how they would expect a subdivision of an APR to be requested, but wasn't their standard at the time. So they need to sort of figure out how to deal with the fact that they didn't ask to do that, ask us to do that at the time. And yet, if we were to ask them now, they would ask us to do that. So it's a little arcane, but that's sort of the, you know, I think the problem really is on them to figure out how to resolve that, because they can't really ask us to take the garden out or undo things that they clearly knew about and approved of at the time. But they need to find a way to justify that internally without creating a precedent that other people might cite and say, well, you let them do that, so now you're going to let us do that. So I think that's kind of their issue, and they're taking their time about it because they don't want to create precedents that cause problems elsewhere. That's my perception of it. So it sounds kind of bad, but at the same time, there's no, you know, they can't make us undo what we've all collectively, your investment and our hard work done, you know, and I'm pretty confident that that's not going to come to pass. They'd have a bit of a riot on their hands in this community. So I don't really think that's the path that's headed down. I think it's more a matter of they need to spend a little more time internally figuring out how they want to move forward.
Let me ask just two quick questions. One is, has the price gone up since this has been delayed for so long, and do you still have enough money to cover the structure with the existing budget?
That actually remains to be seen. But if the price has gone up, I was not anticipating coming back to CPA for additional funds. So if there's a need for additional funds, I was anticipating finding a way to raise that difference on our own. Because obviously it's not something that I could have anticipated, but also not something that the community is necessarily responsible for, or that I would feel comfortable making that sort of request for. More time would be great, but I think we'll figure out how to work within the budget.
And we will hope to not see you again for this, but if in fact this does not get approved, you would then come back to us with how to reallocate funds or return funds to us, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right. And there's a whole next set of needs consistent with the grant that some of which would be sort of substitutes for these proposed buildings, but non-permanent versions, and some of which might be other things that we haven't been able to get to yet, that we would move up the priority list and come back and propose doing in 2016 if we really were not able to do these buildings. But you know, it's our hope that we will be able to buildings, because they'll be really nice, long-lasting assets for the garden.
Sarah, are there any restrictions on how on the extensions?
There's not. We would have to go back.
So self-imposed.
Yeah, it would be the contract approval process. So that would have to all be approved by the mayor and the auditor, but otherwise, no.
Other questions?
Can I make a motion?
Please.
Without cutting off discussion, I would move to request to move to approve a 1-year extension of Rural Food Northampton CPA grant, remaining grant. Under the now, I guess, identified as contract on 2014.
Second.
Second.
Question.
What?
Second.
Discussion?
I'd just like to see if there's a way we can incorporate your comment, which is that Grow Food has an obligation under whatever vote we have to make it positive, but they come back and let us know what the result was, whether it's positive or negative, and if it's negative, what the next steps may be.
Motion so amended.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? All right, thank you, Claire.
Thank you very much, I appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you. It's the government.
So next on item on the agenda is the request by the Northampton Historical Commission regarding the State Hospital memorialization, is that actually that word, committee? Again, sort of a asking for an extension. And someone, we have a couple folks to present, thank you.
I'm Tom Riddell, and this is Martha Lyon, and we're both on the Northampton State Hospital Memorialization Committee. And I hope that you all got a letter. And long story short, this has been a project that has moved very, very slowly over the years, probably mimicking the redevelopment of the state hospital in its early years. It moved glacially. Now it seems to be moving very, very rapidly. And our hope is that the memorial project will have a similar fate, moving slowly and very rapidly. We received a $75,000 grant in 2012. Since then, a lot of our energy has been focused on presenting a plan, a design for the site to the planning board. That got delayed several times, but as a result of the talent and the ability and the volunteer time of Martha, we came up with a very nice design that we developed and changed several times, but the planning board finally approved recently. And we've had some fundraising success in addition to the grant that we got from CPA. There was an auction of some property that had been recovered from the closing and eventual demolition of the hospital, and then also there have been some individual donations. So in addition to the $75,000 from CPA, there's about $7,000 in an account with the city for under the Northampton Historical Commission and dedicated to this project. One of the other things that slowed us down a little bit was the process that was required to make a determination about what our options were with restoring the fountain. That went out to bid. We have a preliminary estimate for what it would cost to restore the fountain kind of in totality to what it was like when it was in operation. And then another estimate for what it would cost to restore basically the parts that we have at the moment. But the other thing that slowed us down is that mass development. We thought that when the planning board approved the site and design plan that mass development was going to turn the property over to the city, but that hasn't happened. The most recent thing that we heard was that they wanted us to have all of the money that we needed to develop the site in hand before they would turn the property over to us. And I think that there have been discussions between the city and mass development about that, but that's one of the other things that slowed us down a little bit. And so we'd like to make two requests. One, a three-year extension on the grant that we received. And hopefully that 3 years will give us time to make progress and eventually complete this project. And then the other is to eliminate the clause that requires CPA funds to be used first on fountain work. We'd like to be able to use the funds that we have. And then we've also, one of the other things that we've done is we've developed some fundraising material. These are a shorter version, and there's enough for everybody. And then I've got three copies of a sort of longer version, and I'll pass those around. You can take take a look at those. So we're getting ready. We've gotten a couple people who work at Smith College in development who've attached themselves to our group and given us a lot of good ideas and energy towards launching a fundraising drive. And we're hoping to accomplish that relatively soon. So those are our two requests. One is to extend the grant, the duration of the grant, and then the second is to free up those funds so that we could spend them for some of the other things that we'll need to spend running on. The one version of the budget for the project that you'll find in the fundraising material, there's a budget projection, and the total for all the landscaping, et cetera, and then for a full restoration of the fountain is over, at this point, it's over $250,000. We're hoping to get some of that work donated by contractors and suppliers, but that's an attempt to estimate the overall cost of the project. Questions?
So Mass Development says you have to have the entirety of funding, which means you'd have to have the $250,000 before beginning, is that correct?
Something like that, or somewhere around there. We'd have to, presumably, if they were going to hold to that, we'd have to continue in more detailed conversations with them about exactly how much funding we need to bring the project to conclusion.
And at this point, you have $82,000.
Somewhere around there.
I sat on the committee under Mayor Ford for the advisory committee on the development of Pompey Hill, and Mass Development at that point made it very clear that they were reserving a memorial space for this purpose, and it was never any strings attached to it, and it was clear that it wasn't going to be very large, but it was committed. And if we, on our own, decide to go ahead and put a fountain on it, in a sense, that seems like it's the city's decision after the fact, and shouldn't be regulated or shouldn't be constrained by Mass Development. I'd certainly be very happy to have a meeting with the mayor on that topic, because it seems like somebody's sort of changing horses midstream, and it doesn't seem right. What Mass Development's rationale is in making that argument?
I believe it's because this is how they approach all of the property at the Northampton State Hospital site, that anyone who's going to develop a parcel or a set of parcels needed to have all their funding in place before they turn Mass Development will turn the land over to them. This is a little different because it's a park. It's
not Would you have an adequate funding currently or within easy sight to acquire that little piece of property and as an undeveloped piece of property? I assume you would.
An undevelopable piece of property.
That's right. That's a good point.
In other words, if you said we're going to acquire it and it's going to be a piece of lawn, do you have enough money?
Probably.
I mean, I have no idea how much.
Yeah, I think so.
Somebody appraised more.
Yeah.
I have no idea. It's really not buildable. I mean, only I think 2/3 of it are a very steep slope, and it's only a quarter of an acre to begin with.
Yeah.
Do you want to say something about what the arrangements might be for clearing?
Right. So there is a. We have are in the process of working on an arrangement with the owner of the prospective owner of the property to the north of the park. It's going to be developed into a house lot, and the contractor that's going to be building that has offered to clear and grub our site in exchange for using it as a staging area for his materials while he builds a house, which is a great deal, really. He's going to protect the fountain base and all of that. Sarah, you may know about more recently about this, but I know there's been some discussion between the planning staff and the mayor's office, going back through some of the old documents that were exchanged between Mass Development and the city about this, because the language in the documents state that Mass Development is not only supposed to turn the land over, just they're also supposed to build this park, finance and build it. I think the staff doesn't believe that they're going to finance and build it, but it may give us some bargaining ability to get the land.
So the mayor is talking to Mass Development about that. They're still sticking to the same argument that all the funding has to be in hand, but it's being worked on.
So it puts us in a real bind, because it's hard to raise money for a property that we don't own. So. Really hard to raise money for a property we don't own.
And the $286,000 park project budget does not include land acquisition, correct?
It does not, no, because we're assuming that that's going to be a gift, or you want to call it that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that my understanding is that Mass Development has said that they will transfer it to the city.
It would absolutely state it without shadow of a doubt.
Right, and without qualification.
Without qualification, that it was being turned over for that purpose as memorial park.
Kevin?
I love Dave's idea of talking to the mayor, but it seems like, I mean, this is a perfect situation where you transfer the lot for a dollar. I mean, that's the kind of thing you need, that, you know, that solves the problem. That meets their rule, it meets the intent of what you heard in the first place. And I think that's what we ought to tell them we want them to do.
Tell who? The mayor?
That the mayor should be talking to Mass Development about a need for the park to be transferred so that we can then develop it. So the park land.
Well, I mean, there are a lot of ways to structure it from a legal standpoint. You can have a reverter clause, that if they don't have fundraising, maybe it's certain, then it reverts back to Mass Development. But there are a couple of things going on here. One is, I love the project, so I'm in favor of it. But we also had a very ambitious schedule when we first came in. Basically, once you got the money, everything would be completed within a year. And we got 2 years worth of progress reports from January of 2013 or 14, where we said, we had you on board, things were rolling, you were going to be before the planning committee, and they've been doing fundraising, painted very rosy picture. And then this last one from 2015, not as robust, but it seemed to be going in the right direction. So we're now at the end, and I recognize there are limitations in the committee. Everyone volunteered, we're doing everything we can, and we bumped up against a big obstacle. And I'm kind of in the same place. I mean, Mass Development has its pros and cons as a working partner, but we also have strength in our mayor's office to help resolve these things. And as a committee, we may be able to push, because our vote to give the money was contingent upon certain of their representations. With that said, we've got $75,000 on the table. So my question is more in terms of doing the restoration of the fountain, which we prioritize as number one. So similar to Mass Development, we didn't want to see a park developed and then not have cash to put the fountain in, which would be the historic aspect that we are authorized to commit the money to. And so that's our priority. So what is it about the nature of things now, that $75,000 available, that it should be spent on something else other than the fountain restoration? And if, can you do fountain restoration now?
We could probably restore the pieces that are there. It would not allow us to do any kind of development within the park, so that there would be no pedestrian access to it, no seating. It would just be a fountain put back into the granite base that's there. That could be done. So that could be done.
I mean, arguably, they wouldn't put that on there if there's no park to go with it. So you would have to store it somewhere pending placement.
Yeah, which would be,
And the estimate we got, the budget reports it down at the bottom in a footnote, that the estimate that we got from the people who did the first round was that it would be about $75,000 to restore what we had.
Yeah, could you clarify what you're looking to repurpose the money four, because as David said, there are some particular uses that the money, categories of use that the money needs to be directed towards.
I think it's to work towards developing the site itself. You know, there needs to be some regrading, there needs to be walkways put in, some seeding, some planting.
And I guess I'm just not understanding why you want to switch the use from the fountain, restriction on the fountain to, if you need all of the funding anyway, why do you need to rejigger what goes where? I'm just not quite following the dilemma that you apparently have.
Well, this is just from a completely, objective point of view, but I think just from a experience, you know, developing parkland. If we were to just restore the fountain pieces and spend the money on that, it probably would end up going back to the DPW in a crate and sit there for a long time until, you know, maybe someday we would have the money. If we were to take the $75,000 we have, try to get some donations like the clearing we're having done, possibly some donated materials, we may actually be able to construct the park itself. The land itself, the fountain would remain unconstructed, it would remain in pieces and not conserved, but we would have a park. And then the park would be something that's visible, you could see, you can visit, you can interact with, without a fountain. And I think our thought is, and again, this is working from experience and working a lot of public spaces, if you have something that's visual to show that they can come to and they can see, it's an enhanced or an enticement for raising money.
So that leads me to ask Sarah, since I was not here at the time, did we really need to use this for some kind of historic preservation in order to satisfy that set aside, or is there a?
That's a good point.
It definitely is eligible as an open space recreation project.
Yeah,
I think the argument could also be made that the entire thing is historic preservation, and that's the way that the committee presented it.
Although there's the possibility that the fountain would never be there, so I'm not sure why putting in a park.
Yeah, I mean, it sort of came in as a joint package with the fountain and the park, and the committee decided at that point only to fund the fountain and not the park.
But did it? Was that necessary to meet that year's historic preservation set aside?
That's a good point, Lynn. Well, Sarah's researching that.
I mean, it did come out of the preservation reserve. But we have to get into what parts of the project are historic and what parts.
I mean, I think it's a terrific project and support the quest for extension, but I ask you to remember the Statue of Liberty mode too, which is they built it actually in part and then displayed it several places in a fundraising effort that was quite successful because people could see it, and it wasn't a dream at that point. They could see it, and they just seemed to find a pedestal for it. So that works too.
And to answer your question with a slightly different answer, I think that part of what we're looking for is just flexibility. You know, we know that we don't have the $250,000. Our hope is that we're going to continue fundraising and raise more of those funds. And what we're hoping for, I think, is flexibility with the funds that we do have, given that we have a fountain restoration as a part of the project, and then preparing the park is another part of our responsibility to develop a memorial to the hospital. And there are other bits and pieces too. We're going to have the plan is to have some signage in the park, and then also some signs around the rest of what used to be Hospital Hill, reminding people about what used to be there and about the history of the institution.
It seems like an awful lot of money to raise. and I wasn't here as part of the discussion, and I don't want to revisit, it's not appropriate to revisit the committee's decision, but it would help me to understand, you know, where are you thinking of getting this? Is there, what kind of plan is there?
So we do have, a roughed out sort of fundraising plan. I can't really speak in detail about it because I haven't been involved in that part of it, but I know that.
Would you mind stopping? Get some cryptomatic.
Sure, I'll let that lit up. I wouldn't want your name to be in the book. That would be fairly bad. So we do kind of have the bones of a fundraising plan. I can't speak a lot of detail about this because I haven't been that involved in it, that part of it. But I do know there's a plan to talk to potential donors of materials, so things like concrete and plant material. We have the one offer to do the clearing and grubbing, which, you know, lops some money off the budget. And then there is a plan to talk to some potential, you know, larger donors. And this property is, is on Hospital Hill, and I'm sure you all know that the population up there is going to grow a lot in the next, I don't know how many years, 5, 10 years, something like that. I think the site is going to get developed. There are 85 units of housing going in just to the north of the mountain that haven't been started yet, and then an entire co-housing project. So this is going to be a big, big Northampton neighborhood. So it's not like, I think a lot of times people thought it was, for a long time, people thought it was sort of a private little park for this small group of people living up there, but it's really going to be a big place. So I think it will have a prominent location, and hopefully, you know, some of the people who are really involved up there will want to donate. That's our plan. Am I saying that?
Yeah, and then there's also a grant under preparation to Mass Humanities to help fund the signage.
So
that's on that. Are there questions? So there are two different requests. One is for a 3-year extension. The second is that we free up how to spend that $75,000, that it would not just go to the fountain, but would be at your discretion. Should we entertain those two as separate, or we?
Should we hear from Sarah whether she's been able to figure
out? Oh, right,
out
thank you.
So, because it did come in as both a recreation and historic request, it's sort of going back and trying to put the pieces back together. But we did also fund the City Hall facade that year, and that would have taken the 10% care of that was required,
so it's not an issue.
So we have that flexibility. So we can entertain both requests together. We could do one at a time. Is there a motion?
Okay. Ask one more question. Uh-huh. In terms of your cost when you went out for the restoration, the original proposal had about $46,000. It sounds like it's gone up by $30,000 just for what's existing, less the additional stuff.
Yeah. And if I, it's sort of off the top of my head, maybe Sarah has the numbers, but I think that when we submitted the request to CPA, it was the budget at that point was about 120, maybe. Is that about right, Sarah?
$145.
And what's increased subsequently, the fountain restoration, what we have as well as a full restoration, and the full restoration came out of meetings that we had and discussions we had with the planning board. And then the other thing that's been added on was developing mass development as part of identifying the parcel of land did present a design, but that design was really insufficient for the property and what really needed to be done. And so Martha came up with a much superior plan. And that much superior plan has some extra costs associated with the grading and putting in walkways. The walkway that connects to the trail system that the new developer, Energy Positive Homes, I think they're calling themselves now, and they're required to connect to more or less to develop and connect to the existing trail system up there. Martha's design connects to to that trail system.
Yeah, the planning board asked us to do that, so we had to increase the amount of walkway. There's also the Daffodil Project that was folded into this, which is a project to memorialize patients through the use of planting daffodils that will multiply on site. That was going to be on a different location, and we ended up incorporating it into the park.
So our vision got loftier and attached to that word, added costs.
I also wasn't here at the time of the original application, and I've only been on this committee for a year, but I guess I'm sitting here thinking, why not give this back and come in with a new application for a greater amount of money for what you need at this point? Because I know that you, what I'm hearing is you came in and asked for two aspects and you got one, and now it's 3 or 4 years later, and I have no experience with changing it, and when I hear this ground's going to be cleared in exchange for a staging area, that feels like who knows when he'll finish. You know, that feels really iffy too. And so I just wonder if that's even been, I appreciate that there are volunteers doing this, so it's a big effort to put in an application, but has that been discussed at all?
Not in that direct a way.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think if that's something that committee would entertain, I think we certainly could discuss mm-hmm. that.
And yeah.
An alternate to that might be that we are open to additional grant requests. Normally, we don't like to see incremental or piecemeal funding of things, as you can imagine. But on the other hand, it's been 3 years since we last heard this application. We approved it, and this is not a new request. It's just an extension of a three-year-old request. So either go for a bigger one or now. Encourage my colleagues to be open to an additional application for some other aspect of the project. Maybe the additional, maybe the single larger would be better, because it seems like a paltry sum for a terrific project.
Linda?
I'm still trying to wrap my head around this. Don't your options change significantly if Mass Development is willing to give you to say, okay, we'll give it to you without condition, and we'll turn it over now? Then
they would help.
Then you really don't need to ask for a 3-year extension. You could just perhaps do the fountain, and that's it. So I'm just wondering if there's a way that I think keep coming back, but if there's a way to do this a little bit incrementally, because it seems like that's such a big unknown, and it really shifts what you're able to do and what you really need from us. There's something that just makes me uncomfortable about 3 years and use it however you want, mm-hmm. and when it's already been 3 years. I'm just trying to define a little bit more and see if it. Without trying to throw real, you've had a lot of roadblocks, and I don't want to throw more roadblocks.
Mm-hmm. That is a good question. You're right to ask these questions. I think, again, from an overall, looking at the overall project, I think it's going to have the most impact if we can redevelop the landscape. I mean, I hate to say that because I know you funded the fountain, but I think, again, as I mentioned, it could get restored and then created. Because there's no money to reinstall it, and then there's no access to the site because we don't have any walkways, and it really just ends up being like a vacant parcel with this crated fountain, and that's really not, I don't think, a great use of money. You really want to have something that's visible, that people can enjoy, they can visit, they can see it growing and developing and maturing, and then the fountain can get restored at any time, really. It's just a matter of money. And it probably should be not just left dumped in the DPW boneyard. Just been in the last
couple of
years. Yeah. That's not helping matters at all.
I just want to clarify, because there are some people who haven't been here, and we can reserve this to when we actually have the discussion. Mm-hmm. All about
the Mass Development is not telling you what the cost of the lot and the development
is. It's based on your budget that's coming from, right?
Right, there's no land acquisition cost in the budget. The assumption is that it's going to get you over.
So if you proposed a $75,000 park, mm-hmm. and you had $75,000 in hand,
right.
then Mass Development doesn't have an argument.
That's, I guess that's true, yeah. unless they yeah. require the funds
yeah.
to do
part yeah, I mean, that. Right. Yeah. You could say that in some ways we were on the worst end.
Right. Well, I mean, we do have the option of funding part, obviously. I'm not as confident about it there because we've leveraged parks out of the developers in different places on the hill. Mm-hmm. And so there are little pocket parks fitting around there.
Yeah.
So what made this one fabulous was the historic fountain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but I do think that we won't turn our back on that fountain after all this history.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just planting. I'm just planting an idea. That's just one. Anything I could help do to get around Mass Development, I would be.
Yeah, we all have a similar. It's our group of people.
Before we decide to vote or not vote on that, I think that's a really good point. Is that we've got Linda and Devin have already said it, which is we've got an issue with Mass Development. It's tying your hands in terms of what you can do and how you want to approach your fundraising. The committee was firmly behind this, and the issue that we had wasn't we want to fund one or the other. The issue we had was the price tag that was associated with the development of the park seemed exorbitant for the size and the amount of work that was being done. And we thought it was more prudent to give you essentially half of what you're requesting to cover the fountain. Put the fountain first, but there would be residual to kick into the park, but not all of the park, so that it would force you to go back and leverage the in-kind contributions of excavation or
right.
things like that.
Yeah.
So it wasn't an either or for those
right.
who weren't here.
Right.
But there was such unanimous support for this project. I'm wondering if this is a place where CPC, through its chair, might exert some influence either with the mayor or with Mass Development or a letter of support to say our voting was contingent on your commitment and you already have a commitment from this committee for half of what was proposed. There's no doubt that this is going to happen, but now at Mass Development, you're stumbling across just one more piece of pressure. I don't know what we do in the meantime with your extension. If you grant a temporary one-year extension to see how this is resolved. I'm also not opposed to, you know, what Tony is suggesting, which is to come back. My concern is not that it won't get done. It might take a while to get done, but what you're talking about now is a very different project than what we voted on. You have new elements of new signage that we haven't looked at.
Yes, it's evolved, for sure.
And so there may be opportunity, I can't speak for what the committee will do in the future, for more funds. It may be that we prioritize the fountain still as number one, but the full fountain is more important. Before it was just partial fountain. Now you have more information about what the true cost of the fountain is, and maybe having more money or different setup from us may move Mass Development in a different way. I just see different ways of getting there.
Yeah.
And part of it is politics and discussion,
mm-hmm.
which is beyond the issue of extension. That seems
yeah,
the most prudent one
is.
To resolve.
Yeah.
Is there a motion?
Then move to permit the extension of the original grant for 3 years and to allow the committee and the supervisors to have the latitude to use the funds toward the total development of the project as long as it comports with the plans that have been submitted to us.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
I would feel a little more comfortable voting on it separately rather than tied to it.
I can't hear you.
I would be a little more comfortable voting on them separately, the two elements separately, than tying them together.
I'll rescind my motion. Can you just go with the motion being I have two motions. First motion is that we allow the extension of the grant that was originally given to this committee for another 3 years because of the reasons given by the petitioners.
Second? Discussion on that?
What's the deadline? I mean, they're obviously here because time's running out, so.
March, whatever.
February, it says in the letter.
So we've talked about some advocacy, a few different angles, trying to see if we can clear the logjam. Because I'd like to know about this. Do we have to go on?
There's a motion on the table.
So, yeah. And I'm wondering, maybe they wouldn't care at all, but I'm wondering if the committee saying, got a year and this is really got to get going, is going to, would put any pressure on, would give you any arguing rights with mass development. You know, we got $75,000, we're going to lose it if we can't resolve this.
Right.
With an understanding that the committee would be very welcoming, if necessary, to a further extension, and that it's really for.
Okay, so you're
tactical.
In the spirit of discussion, what do you think of Devin's comment that what we need to do to meet their demand is simply make the current scope of the project equal to our grant?
It's not through permitting process, doesn't it?
I mean, this woman is dealing with government, so.
Oh, yeah, I mean, that's the other thing that, you know, the permitting, the design and permitting of this is, you know, it's a hefty amount of work, and so that's a whole
I'm not sure how you make the case that it's really a $75,000 project when you permitted a 200 and something thousand dollar project.
Right.
It's kind of hard to erase that.
I know, I went and looked at the estimate to see if it had any land cost in it.
No, it does not.
Right.
Yeah. Because that assumption was there.
Can we consider, I won't be here, but would you consider, since this doesn't expire until February 7th, what's the turnaround to get a contract extension done? What's the lead time that would be needed?
This is sort of a goofy one because it's city funds and it's intercity. It doesn't, they don't go away. So this is just sort of like more a gentleman's agreement between the CPC and the Historical Commission.
So would it be reasonable to see, you know, we've got until January next year, a month or two, to see what wonders you can work with Mass Development? I would entertain CPC inviting Mass Development to come to us and talk to us about what this issue is and why they're holding up the project that we funded, and speak to us with you here in the room and facilitate that discussion.
That's a great idea.
Or for Brian, if you can meet with the mayor or something like that, and just insert ourselves into that discussion to help you out, but also find out what's truly going on. Not that we don't believe you, but to hear it from the horse's mouth, whichever appendage you think it's coming from. And make a decision at that point. It may be that, you know, maybe we go with a different application process at that time, or maybe it's going to be a year extension, or maybe at that point you don't need to have the flexibility that you think now. And I'd rather not commit this committee to 3 years if we don't need to, because it's money that's being tied up.
Can you speak up? I'm sorry. You got to accommodate me a little bit here. I'm trying.
How's that?
No, you're a lawyer. You can tell you.
I don't know. I think time is on our side, and there's no reason for us to rush. This is somewhat of a new issue. It's a new project. We haven't been able to look at what the new project is. I would feel more comfortable waiting and putting it in your hands in January once you have full information and have a chance to vet it with the mayor.
If the 3 years is up, can we sort of after the fact? Because I don't want them to have to keep coming back and not have an answer. And I just want to make sure there's enough time to really work on that.
Yeah, I mean, these funds will sit there unless the committee actively requests them back, or the applicant says we can't make it work.
So this gentleman agreement can be extended retroactively, essentially?
Yeah, that's so, with an MOU that's interesting.
So we don't have to meet that, we don't have to act by February.
No, we're not going to be extending the funds in February or, you know, in March, we won't be doing that.
Devin?
It is almost February. I say you come before us, we should do something. I don't think putting it off till February helps much.
Well, I was suggesting it be put off a little bit longer.
Well, and I like your 1 year for the very logic of that's enough time to get a story working.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know, it doesn't mean you're coming back to us repeatedly. And I think it's been a great discussion to say how did we get here and who needs to be involved. And I think Mass Development does need to realize that the way they've structured this, it's not working.
There's a motion for a 3-year extension that is on the table and was seconded. Should we be voting on that? Are we ready to vote on that?
My motion, let me just ask the petitioner, what do you think of that 1 year?
Given the discussion that we've had this evening, we'll clearly bring all of that back to the committee. And it seems to me that a 1 year extension would satisfy us as well as respond to the discussion.
So keep your money on the table as you deal with men.
And give us some time to drum up some more support.
Yeah.
I change my motion to 1 year rather than 3 year.
Second. So I would just want to, would the CPC entertain us coming back after a year to acquire more funds, apply for more funds if we needed to, or if we get this thing straight around?
Well, the other thing I heard was that the committee should talk about whether or not we want to come back with it, the revised proposal, the new proposal.
Right. And so we would have another.
I haven't heard that we couldn't.
I haven't heard that either.
I would like to see you come back and ask for more money, frankly, and so that you're more likely to get the project done, as well as this advocacy we're talking about.
Okay.
It seems like we'll give you this little piece and you're still stuck and your hands are still pretty tight.
Yeah, it's pretty tough.
Yeah.
And anyone who says you're spending a lot of money on a small piece of land should look at what we're spending next door.
Well, this is, and I think people have to realize, this is my profession, but landscape construction is very expensive. It's like building a building. It's just, people think it's like going to the nursery and picking up a couple of shrubs and throwing them back in your station wagon. That's not what it is. It's very expensive. And so if you really want to invest in something and make it beautiful and last a long time and memorable, it's an investment. And Pulaski Park is a great example of that.
So the motion's on the table and seconded for a 1 year extension. Are we ready to vote? All in favor of a 1 year extension? All opposed? Passed unanimously. Do we have a second motion?
The second motion is to
eliminate the clause that requires.
No, I don't have a second motion.
Does anyone have a second motion? Remember, the second request was to eliminate the clause that the $75,000 be spent only on fountain work. Is there a second motion?
I'll make a motion to to allow the funds to be expended on the park itself.
Is there a second? There is no second, so there is no motion.
Comment?
Yes.
Can it happen after that?
I'm sure we can comment whenever we want to comment.
We do anyway. I think that depending on how the conversation goes with your committee and with the mayor and with the historic commission, that would not be an unthinkable thing to do if we just had a plan. But I don't think this committee is willing to take off the condition without knowing what is
right. Yeah, there are a lot of unknowns.
We appreciate that.
Thanks for the discussion. This is really productive. It's great to actually sit down and have a productive conversation.
Yeah. Can I just add a further comment? How Dave's notion of the inviting Mass Development, how does that happen? Is that going to be discussions between the volunteers and you? Is it? I just. we don't want to.
We've done that with planning board, but we've got a little leverage usually when that comes up, because they're trying to help assist one of their developers to get something through. And so we kind of have a little leverage. Have you?
It may be most useful at this point for the committee or Brian to communicate with the mayor what a priority transfer of this property is. Because there is it's supposed to be monthly, but I don't think it happens very often anymore. Just a sort of an update meeting about possible.
So we can begin with that, with the chair contacting the mayor and requesting a transfer, correct?
Yeah, or just that whatever he can do to
expedite the process.
Yeah. Development to transfer this to the city.
Yeah, because the other thing too, remember, is even if the fountain were restored, we don't have legal access to the property because we don't own it. The city doesn't own it, so we couldn't put it back anyway. So we can even clear up there.
Yeah, that's just such a very different story than what it started out. It really is.
Sorry.
That's so very different than where it started out.
Yeah, where are the master documents about the relationship between that development and that property?
There's a lot of them. So the city will produce something and it looks very clear and everyone signed it, and then Mass Development will say, but after that we have this other MOU that says this, and there's a lot of
these smudgy sort of signatures down here at the bottom, kind of. Yeah.
I mean, it was different MOUs.
I've spent a lot of hours on the Citizens Advisory Commission. I remember what was said, and it was pretty clear. And I'm sure the mayor would also want to counter planning some guidance as well.
And you're not alone in recalling it the way that you're recalling it.
Good. Even if I were, I know I'm right. That was important.
Everybody recalls it the same way you do, except for Mass Development.
So, I'll talk with you about setting up, trying to find time to set up an appointment with Mayor and talk to him about it, because I'd really like for him to carry water on this for us.
Yeah, I think he'd be willing to. He needs a place to start. I think he needs a place to start, but I think he's definitely willing to do that.
They need to give the city title to that property. I'm talking.
Yes, so David, if there's anything we can do to assist you on that, please don't hesitate to call us.
Devin?
You had sort of taken an action item to do that on behalf of the CPC, and you could take an action to do it on behalf of the Historic Commission, mm-hmm. and that's a better way to approach that.
Okay, I'll bring it on behalf of that. Right. That's my assumption.
That would be great.
Yeah, I was only going to comment that since you're the chair of the planning board and you've reviewed it, also maybe it makes sense for all three of you to have a three and I are and represent your perspective, so here's an all in one. Just a suggestion.
Good. Actually, the planning board's role here has not been most helpful because we leveraged some requirements that are costing them money. But yes, I hear you.
Sarah assured me at the start of this meeting that these two items would take. So the goat food
Our interest was to punish Jim for the
sorry, Jim.
So Jim, you've been very patient. Thank you so much. So before we get, in recognition that Jim has sat through an hour plus of stuff, rather than begin discussion on specific stuff, can we get back to our discussion of 2 weeks ago asking Jim to clarify the condition that he is requesting regarding the $200,000 for the siting putting utilities underground at Pulaski Park? And Jim, we asked you to come in, and thank you for coming, because the condition that you asked us to consider, we were confused about and felt that we needed further clarification. So that's what hopefully you will guide us.
So like an engineer, I always say it requires a table to make things clearer. So what I just handed out is it's a summary of construction funding and expenses that we've incurred on the Pulaski Park Phase 1 project and the underground utility project that's ongoing right now. So I'll just walk you through the table so you'll understand specifically what this contingency is that I'm asking for and the change in language that I had suggested to Sarah earlier. So the top box basically is a summary of the total funding that we've pulled together through various sources for the Pulaski Park Phase 1 project and the Chiefly Underground project that we spoke about. You can see the total funding is $1.9 million, and it's based on the grant funding from CPC, the State Park Grant, money from the Stormwater Utility Fund that we're using for drainage and stormwater-related features of the park, Chapter 90 funding, which is state MassDOT funding that we're using to replace that sidewalk that we're rebuilding right now, the Mountain View's doing, so that's sort of the money that's pulled together. The middle box that you'll see are contracts related to these projects that we have signed and the value of them. And these have been paid for using CPA funds that have been awarded. So there was basically four contracts. Kleinfelder was a utility design contract. Caracas is a contractor that's constructing the underground utility condo with some other structures that are necessary. We recently approved a utility charge for Verizon for work related to the underground utility. And then the Mountain View base bid is the value of the contract that we have with Mountain View Landscape, who is doing the main park project. So if you sum those contract values and you subtract it from the total funding that we've made available for the project, the current contingency there at states is about $51,314. So that's the excess of funds that exist today for any unforeseen costs that come up associated with the work that we're doing. Now the bottom box shows utility charges that are still to be incurred. We have final estimates now from the various utility companies. The National Grid estimate went up quite a bit from what I had presented in the CPA application for reasons that we can't really seem to beat out of them. We have very little leverage with the utilities to understand what the basis of their cost is. But in any event, if you look at the total of the utility charges still to be incurred, it's about $161,000. So the $161,000 is more than the money that we have available to pay. And that was the driver for us to look for $200,000 for additional utility funding. So what I've done at the bottom here is to show that the phase one contingency total, if the CPA requests the $200,000 is awarded in this round, the phase one contingency will be $90,262. So the reason that I've asked for the flexibility, and I had suggested language to Sarah that the language would be underground utility work or other construction expenses related to construction of Pulaski Park improvements. And the reason I was looking for that broader language than just underground utility work is because I would like to have that contingency money available for the Mountain View contract. It's $1.5 million job in the park. There's a chance that there may be changes during the course of the job, and we need to have some contingency money for unforeseen conditions or things that come up during the project. Wouldn't be our intention to spend any contingency money if we don't need it. But given the different contracts that we have active, the potential need for contingency exists. With the Caracas contract on the underground utility work out here, the Mountain View bid, and their contract on the main Pulaski Park project. And while we have final estimates from each of the utility companies, all of those utility company contracts have language in there that says if they incur additional costs that the city is responsible for X, Y, and Z that they weren't aware of at the time they gave us the estimate. So we're hoping that those estimates are pretty solid, but there could be a situation where we would need additional funding to make that project whole. So that's a lot of detail, and I felt that might be the best way for you to understand why I was asking for the change.
Jim, can you read the language one more time of the condition change that you would like us to entertain?
Sure. I requested that the money can be used for underground utility work or other construction expenses related to construction of Pulaski Park improvements.
Thank you. Discussion? Questions for Jim?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm a little slow tonight.
So are you thinking, perhaps correctly, that the money, the initial award of funding has to be used in what's in this contract box? In other words, you've got a bunch of utility costs up here. Why can't we, if you just took the $200,000 and applied it to the Caracas utility conduit bill, wouldn't that resolve your problem?
Well, it doesn't, because as an example, I guess the Caracas contract has been applied to an existing grant.
Has been paid already?
Not all of it. The project's underway. But the $212,000 is the value of their contract that will be funded through the CPA grant. So the
I'm just wondering why you can't just do a switcheroo. But Sarah, tell me if that's not something you can do.
So you've already figured that out of Parks, right?
Right, from the CPA grant. It's the Caracas contract has been assigned to the CPA grant. So the crux of the problem is that...
But is that an internal notation, or is that something that you're somehow bound by? Can you just not reallocate internally?
I'm not sure I'm following that.
I'm not sure I'm following,
let me try to elaborate a little bit to see if I can help, okay? Yeah. So the crux of the problem that we face is that the current contingency that we have is $51,000. Mm-hmm. We have $161,000 of additional charges that are going to come in now. So if I use the $51,000 to pay some of those costs, like I could pay the AXIA bill, the G4S bill, the contract bill, using $51,000, but it reduces the amount of contingency available for the amount of the project.
So it's a timing issue, timing of the availability.
In part, it's okay. Part,
well, that right. Helps me a bit, because I'm wondering how come it didn't 161 minus 51 that you've got on hand, so the amount you need is 109. But you're telling me you want to hold a contingency for Mountain View on top of that.
Well, it's a contingency for Mountain View. Could be a contingency for costs that we don't know in the Caracas work that's underway, mm-hmm. or a contingency for the utility bills that have been estimated by the utilities that's subject to change.
What was the original contingency that you built into the original proposal? Utilities aside. There must have been anticipated over 10%.
We actually went into the project with no contingency. And the way we were going to work a contingency was through modification of design. Like if the bids came in high, we would alter the design to get back under the budget that we had. So we were going to build a contingency either by changing the design to make it lesser value or to add sources of funding to increase the contingency that's available. And we did that through the Stormwater Utility Fund and the Chapter 90 Fund. So we really built the contingency for the project by taking allowable sources of funds for certain components of the project, like the sidewalk and the stormwater system. So we need to have some contingency. I mean, normally on a job like this, maybe 5% or something. And as the project goes along, the need for contingency, for the most part, will be less because you've got more work complete. There's less chance that you're going to find something that won't require a change. And, you know, the $90,000, that's the way it would shake out if the $200,000 was awarded. And like I said, we wouldn't spend that unless there's some unforeseen condition that happens that causes us to spend it. But there are a lot of unknowns on it. I mean, it's been hard to pinpoint.
I wouldn't have any problem making your life easier to pay your bills. I just wouldn't want if it ended up that there was contingency that you then put back in some design elements that have been taken out.
We haven't had to do it. I mean, we haven't taken anything out. We got a good bid based on the design, mm-hmm. And we're actually working on one change order for some modification of design elements extends to want to see it's going to save the city a little bit of money. So there's a I forget what the value is, we're negotiating that right now, but.
I thought they had originally had some stuff in there that maybe in earlier time they had taken out because the estimates were coming in too high.
The estimates were high.
So I thought they had done some design revision, so I'm just saying not to go back to an earlier design.
We don't have any plans. We don't have any plans to do that.
Have you heard about the additional $400,000 park grant?
We haven't. We received an email from the state about a week ago apologizing for the fact that they hadn't awarded the park grants. I don't know if you saw the email, Sarah, but.
Yeah, no word on the land grant.
Right.
It's slow.
Other questions for Tim?
Can I just ask you a question about the bidding and budgeting process? If the contractor, obviously they're going to build in their own profit and it's part of the bid, of course. But if they come in with their expenses under the bid, then their profit is bigger. But if they come in and explain, say that they run into unexpected difficulty, then they have a clause that says that they can charge more. It seems like a great contract.
You know, they have to prove that. You know, every contractor in the world will try to, you know, they may all try to do it at some point. But
what's the arbitration process?
Well, it's a negotiation with the city relative to what they're claiming is an unforeseen condition. So, I mean, it's actually quite rare to get into a real struggle with a contractor over change. It's their reputation on the line too. They don't want to make false claims for condition changes that don't exist because that just tricks
them. You've been dealing with different contractors than I have, I guess.
I mean, it's significant in that the city can always choose never to work with a contractor again if they find that they've had a problem working with them.
Okay.
So it's a pretty
except
significant.
Except for National Grid.
Right.
Double what they estimated.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Other questions for Jim? Okay, there's no motion to be made at this time because we will hold this in as a condition when we're discussing allocations. Thank you so much for your patience and coming and clarifying this for us. All right, so we've got a ways to go, folks. If you need a stretch, I'm sure we will. So the good news is that additional money has come in from the state. And I think Sarah sent that out today. Our fiscal year 16 CPA projected budget. Remember, this is for both rounds, our fall round as well as our spring round. Total funds available, people understand that, 1.242 million. We have in our shopping cart, as of last Wednesday, $459,310. If we subtract that from the 1.242 million, that would leave us at 782,000, I think is what Sarah said, for the next round. So if we were to go with what we had suggested, we'd be spending 459 tonight, or suggesting that the city council allocate that, and then we would have 782,000 for the next round. So this is good news, and then again, our state allocation has come in more than anticipated. As a reminder, in our shopping cart at the moment, we have $90,000 for the Rocky Hill Connector. We have $5,000 for Connecticut River Greenway. We have $200,000 for Pulaski Park. We have $30,000 for Fitzgerald Lake. We have $131,310 for Historic Northampton. We have zero for the Academy of Music, zero for the clock, and $3,000 for the Mineral Hills and Basin. And again, that comes to $459,310. And again, the $782,000 would be left for next round. Keep in mind that $782,000 includes $148,000, Sarah's down $145,000, it's actually a little bit more now, $148,000 would have to go into affordable housing or would be put, or would be put into that reserve account. So if in fact we didn't have affordable housing proposals, we would have to subtract 148 from the 782, which would leave us with 634,000 if my math is more or less correct. So are people following this? Does this all make sense?
Yeah, and the change in the set-asides is due to the increase in the state match. So we have to account for that and make sure it's all 100%.
So the set-asides rather than 145 are up to 148, so 2,000 in addition to that. So there are various ways to go about structuring the discussion for the next however long it takes. One is to make a motion, or someone could make a motion, that we spend $459,310 on the items in our shopping cart, if you will, from our discussion 2 weeks ago. If there was a second on that, then we would begin to discuss, and everything becomes on the table. Everything is on the table then, in terms of adding additional funds, taking things back. But perhaps that is one way to start. Another way to start would be just to begin again with each of the projects. What makes sense for folks?
I need that number.
That makes terrific sense. Take a little break. Other people, do you want to stretch?
I would make a motion to go with what was already in the cart and then address additional funds.
Could you then to approve what's in the cart?
I make a motion to approve what's already in the cart.
Yeah.
I think it's 429.
459,310.
459,310 to approve that, and then we can discuss any additional funds to each project.
Or we could also subtract as well.
Yeah. And that way, I think that we'll save a lot of time because we did spend the last meeting discussing each disbursement.
There's a motion on the table. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. So we have discussion on that motion. Dave?
Well, just my comment is relevant to that, and that is that we now have a different sum available to us, which must influence or thinking whenever one is allocating money for disbursement.
Correct.
And I wasn't able, because of professional obligation, I wasn't able to attend the previous meeting. And I wonder if any of the items that were not funded would be eligible for discussion.
Yes.
This evening. Yes.
Yes. So that's what this discussion would be. We're simply getting motion on the table to be able to
proceed. I recognize that. I hope it's been seconded.
It has been seconded.
Great.
Yeah.
Just in time.
Let us welcome our new chair, Tony.
Hey.
We're meeting with the mayor at 11 tonight. New chair,
personally.
Hey,
pee, you lose.
That's not on the agenda.
Okay, so we had a motion and a second to allocate $459,310 on those 6 projects, is that correct?
Yeah.
So, discussion. Linda.
I keep being brought back to the fact that we're gonna have to bond for Pulaski Park. And that's going to be something on the order of $300,000 or so, I think, if we do it for 5 years.
Something like that. I can find
something. And we've got a couple hundred thousand in change continuing obligations on Ian Allard, Florence Fields. So something in excess of $500,000 for many years to come is going to come out of what's available. So that got me to thinking that maybe a couple of the items that we said, well, we support them, we like them, but they should come back later, maybe we ought to just take care of them now and not have them hanging out there and not having them be in
competition with the fountain and the park from the state hospital coming back, but just clear them out. So my thinking was going to, maybe we want to take care of the parking.
At the Greenway.
At the Greenway. Maybe we want to take care of the clock and just get it off the table and funded and done with, since there is, I thought there was a feeling of some kind of a commitment to seeing those through to the end and kind of clear the decks.
Can I make one comment? Don't forget the barn. I know we were all in favor of the barn, and that's one thing that we could add now, the barn to the historic.
I was still thinking personally about leaving that to the next round and putting that in competition with other things coming in.
And did folks get that Sarah sent out the new estimate from the barn, which reduces from 200? It did not come out?
It did. Linda, can I clarify your bonding for the park is what we completed already? Okay.
Yes. Yeah. I wasn't thinking we were entertaining bonding.
I just wanted to make sure I had this data.
So people were aware that the archaeology new bid came in. Boy, what a difference. Thank you. Okay. And that if in fact the handicap bathroom didn't come in, the request for the barn would go from $208,000 to $153,000. So Linda, specifically, you are suggesting relooking at the Greenway and perhaps an additional $45,000 to pave the whatever it's called, whatever the access thing is, plus $30,000, is that right?
Yes.
For the clock.
Yes.
And Marlene, you are suggesting now looking at the $153,000 for the barn.
Yes.
Or it could be more. We could fund plus add $17,000 to that, I suppose, to fund it $170,000, which would include everything now, including the handicap bathroom. So, other discussion.
Would we just discuss now the each one of the, like, would we discuss the parking lot now, or just?
I think everything's on the table. However we want to structure.
I still have a problem with the parking lot, because I'd like to see more effort of the the club to reach out to the rec department and get more of the city involved. And I, as I was thinking about this over the last 2 weeks, there's so many different ways it could be done. There could be it could actually even be a nonprofit created that would could easily, I think, pursue donations. I know so many people that have kayaks in their yards. Could be donated to the nonprofit that would work with the club, and that the club could facilitate keeping kayaks for the public. And then, you know, and then even part of the nonprofit could be to teach people how to use these kayaks, which would stay down there at the parking lots. See, so the problem I have is that all the boats that are there, aren't they all owned by the rowing club? So what I'd like to see before there's any money funded for the private club is a creation of some kind of a idea or even a motivational goal to involve the public. And just as I was thinking about it, there's just so many ways to do it. And I think so many people would easily give their kayak to the organization, whatever it was, as long as it's down there and you can go use it anytime, but also other people can use it. I don't know how many of you know people who have kayaks piled up in their yards, but it's such, you have to put it on your car, you know, it's like, so, I would even work with them to do that. But the way it is right now, there's no motivation, you know, to involve the rec department or to involve the rest of the city. So I'm a little bit, I wouldn't vote for it, don't give them any money at this point.
Why don't we stick with the Greenway? Other people have comments?
I'm new to this committee, and this is going through the first process here that I've witnessed. It seems like there are a lot of projects where I feel the timing isn't quite right, and the value of the project is great, and the ideas are great, and they're well worth the investment, but they don't seem like the timing is quite right. So I think in a lot of these, I was actually happy to see the extra money being available for the, might be available for another round that is still in the budget, because I think some of the things, the timing just appeared wrong from the presentations that were given, and one of them was the Greenway Park, which isn't, the timing of it isn't quite right for them to go to the next phase. And even the project at Historic Northampton, the houses could be done, and then, you know, they could come back in the spring for another timing that would be better for the barn to be rehabilitated. So it seems like there's several things going on that don't involve any negativity about the value of the project. It's just the timing doesn't seem quite right. So I think our shopping cart was a really, I was really comfortable with what we decided on the shopping cart, because our discussions seemed to take into account the timing when we saw things that weren't quite ready for action. So that's my comment.
More Greenway stuff there?
That's what you wanted, right?
Yeah.
That is what you got. I feel like part of our bargain last time when we went through is that there was going to be a commitment to public access as well as handicap access, and that we conditioned our last grant on them having that meeting. Gave them 3 years to do it. They elected to wait till the end of the 3-year cycle to have that meeting. They haven't had it yet. And until they have that meeting and we can see how everyone will benefit, I feel like it's foolhardy to spend money doing a second pavement. They have pavement that's existing that's useful enough. We don't know who the subsequent members and around the area are going to be yet. So I just assume, wait, I don't see it being a pressing issue. And if they come back, we can demonstrate that it's timely and they've got their act together and that it's truly community oriented and there's a need to do it. I'd say go for it then. And I recognize your point. And I think there's a delicate balance between we have money available, so spend it on projects. But I think it's the projects viewed in line with other projects and the equity we afford to the next round of applicants. And I feel just as comfortable that there was a worthy project now spending it, but I also feel comfortable preserving it and hoping that the next round, especially given the fact that we've got other commitments, I'd rather have a surplus going into the future rounds, because we also don't know what the state commitment will be next year. So I think it's hard. I kind of agree that where we came out, I felt, you know, there were a couple of projects that we had disagreements about, but I felt comfortable that in terms of priorities, it's good. If I were to spend money, part of me thinks that, you know, the 153 that Historic Northampton has with the contractor that it has is even, almost an even split of that 379, you know, 50-50 for half now, half later. That might be a better way to do it. I still feel like Seth Thomas Clock, we talked about that one too. You know, I would still want to see the fundraising component for that for the last part. So I don't know if that's right yet. So that can make
something. Does anyone want to speak in defense of allocating additional $45,000 for the Greenway?
I'm being pretty convinced by what other people say.
Can I get support of my colleagues?
Say it again.
Well, I agree completely about timing and about, especially because of accessibility. I love kayaking. Mm-hmm. I think it's a great spot, but the city's going to spend taxpayer money. This needs to be a demonstration piece for providing fully accessible ramping for kayak and canoe access, not simply that. I mean, there's different mechanisms of doing it, but we need to get the, we need to provide the state of the art to making that kind of voting accessible independently for people with mobility issues. And by having local, having kayaks there so that they don't have to be taken off of cars, and also so that we use ramping. Reflecting the weather, I mean, obviously there's going to be an issue of you know, something being better for ice-free zones, but whatever works there needs to provide for our citizens who don't have easy access to their kayaks otherwise. And if, again, it's not too hard, stuff exists now, and this is city money, and we wouldn't have a question about providing ramps on any other project that we're funding, and we shouldn't have any problem, you know, meeting state-of-the-art requirements with this project. And when that's provided, I will vote for it.
Yeah, well.
It has ramps. They're all there. That's the expensive part of it. It's all there.
Is that, I didn't see the access. I mean, I see wheelchair ramps, okay? What I'm talking about now, though, are the ingress and egress arm ramps that are, I know that while the testimony we heard last time was, do it off the beach, that's the best.
Well, I think the connection through the rec department is exactly what ought to happen. I think that it needs to be a broader community awareness and broader use. I actually like the physical project there. I think is in good shape. I just think it needs to have a broader base, and it's going to be hard because of where it is. So.
Are we ready to move on from this? I think we were a sense of the committee to leave it at 5.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct? Why don't we, looking at the 16 overview sheet, maybe we could just go down the list. Maybe that makes sense. Rocky Hill Connector, do we have second thoughts about that? We have full funding for that. Does anyone want to speak to lowering that from our discussion? No? Great. Connecticut River Greenway, we're at this point sticking with 5. Pulaski Park was allocating 200. The suggested condition as articulated by Jim was that we would allocate $200,000 for underground utility work or other construction expenses used for construction of Pulaski Park. We could agree or disagree with that condition, but that is the one that he suggested. We have cut down from $425,000, which is what the request was, to $200,000. Does anyone want to allocate for increasing the amount? No? Does anyone want to go with decreasing the amount? People good with 200? Can we talk about the condition then?
I was going to say the amount partly depends on the condition for me. I'm still struggling with the mathematics here. It sounds like the stormwater utility fund contribution and the Chapter 90 contribution that we used in part to pay some of the utility contingency along with CPA funds. And if there would be no money left over, if there's a contingency issue with the actual work aside from utilities. On the other hand, he said that they didn't build in a contingency. I just feel a little, he's estimated how much it will cost, and it seems like there's going to be $90,000 worth of utilities fees that they're going to need compensation for, not $200,000. And I feel a little bit uncomfortable with just tossing in a $100,000 contingency fee, because that's an incentive in some respects for people to go and say that the money's there and worry about it. And, you know, if they're, I don't know, again, how they decide what stays or what goes. Just seem an odd pitch to me. I get it. Just we feel like we more.
A discussion about the condition?
On the other hand, I think it was kind of crossing their fingers and hoping to go into the project without a contingency. It's very unusual to do that. And I think it would have resulted in things being taken out of the project. So this having the contingency in there, to me, goes some long way towards assuring that what was designed is what's going to get built, and if it doesn't, if it's not needed, it's going to come back.
Sarah, if the contingency wasn't was unnecessary, would that 90,000 then come out of that 200,000 that we're allocating now? Or would it be, would we bond for 90,000 less?
So the way...
Not really. I mean, I think it's set. I think Jim is saying we need 200,000 for utilities. And the committee either takes it or use it. I'm not really sure how they have their funding spreadsheet set up.
So everything that's shown here in the contracts and the utility charge is still to be incurred. That's all based on CPA funds, is that right? So because in the top box, then they're saying, well, okay, right now we have 51,000 in contingency set aside. And if you let us and you give us another 200,000, that creates an extra almost 39,000 for a total of 90,000. So mm-hmm. Are we understanding that that's all CPA money? That's $90,000 of CPA dollars? Is that correct? I don't know.
Yeah. These start getting subtracted from that number,
yeah.
And that number is CPA plus other,
including the park. Yeah.
But I'm with Dave in that what this sheet shows me is that they are 109,000 short based on the estimates in hand, and they're asking for 200. And I hear Linda saying yes, but you have a $1.6 million line item with no contingency.
What's the 1.6?
Is it 1.9?
I'm sorry, I looked at the wrong one. It's Karak, it's Mountain View, 1.55.
So we have two, now we're, so is there a suggestion, Devin, to lower that amount, 200,000, down to 100 and whatever it is, 10 or something?
I'm uncomfortable with it for the same reason Dave is. I'm not thinking that lowering it is going to be really the thing to do, because I've never run into a construction job that didn't have change orders at the end, and that's where this one's going to go.
But so your discomfort is with the condition, is that correct?
No, that's exactly where the change orders will come. The way he has framed that condition is because he knows the change orders will be in the Mountain View.
Alex Russ, my discomfort isn't in the reality of this, because I think they'll probably come back and ask for more money on top of the contingency.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah.
And my discomfort is that every step of the game, we have been asked to provide more and more and more. And it's not more for a new product, it's more for the old product, or Stimson running over two times, yeah. Including this $75,000 for oversight, which if we're having problems with contingencies, things aren't working. And so it's just kind of, it is what it is, we're committed to this, but this is the discussion we have. Once we get our big toe in this, we're not going to get ourselves out. So it feels awkward and yucky.
Yeah, I think it started out, the design work was against an estimate of 1.2.
Right. So, I don't know that changing it makes sense. I don't know that RVM and Jim's condition makes sense. We'll be back. The only thing that coming back will let us know is what went over and what's getting attention again. And that's what we don't know.
It might make us feel better, but I mean, you can just... The writing's on the wall. It's going to be in the big contract line item that's construction. Although I am bothered by the National Grid doubling theirs mm-hmm. with no recourse whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I mean, they don't seem to be able to do what they want.
Mm-hmm. National Grid.
What monopolies.
Yeah, which is the one company you can't, the city can't just say, well, we
right.
deal with you.
So we're all expressing some discomfort with this, the way that this is playing out, mm-hmm. but are we getting the sense that this is inevitable, that the condition is set forth by Jim, while we feel yucky about it?
I know what happened if we were to approve an amount that would pay for the costs that are unavoidable, but not I just have this feeling, I think I share with Dave, that if we give the 200, which allows a 90,000 plus contingency, that that's just going to get vacuumed up and evaporate immediately, as it's seen as funny money. And there'll be a million ways to, but that'll just disappear. And if we kept a shorter leash on this thing, because this is just the first round, and I believe too that there'll be more. We did like 120,000, which would pay for hard costs and believe a very small contingency. That might send a message to the contractors that they need to stay within they need to honor their bid amount. Otherwise, we're just, they keep coming back to us over and over again.
I think that's a good idea. I think it'll make everybody involved think more carefully and not just rely on the ability to come to the CPA every time and it's automatically approved. I think it's a good idea to David's suggestion. I would agree with that 100%.
I have not taken that same journey down the slippery slope with all of you, so I haven't had that experience. My experience is that it's really hard to control costs on a project. It just happens, and I just would hate with just kind of be it just it's I'm going to say nickel and diming. I know it's a lot of money, but. Kind of mucking around with it at this point and, you know, taking, I guess I wouldn't trust the city that they're going to manage it as best they can, and I don't want to be trying to pull the levers behind the scenes, and I want to credit them as professionals and that they'll do the appropriate job and treat these funds seriously.
Well, I think that's important, but we remember that we're just making a recommendation. And if we make a recommendation that's less, it's going to motivate more of a discussion by the city council. And I think if the people involved in funding this, you know, if the mayor and the DPW, if they see that the city council is discussing it, and rather than just taking our recommendation and approving it, there's going to be more thought about the people who are having direct conversations with the contractors. So, I mean, I think because this is just a recommendation, I think it's a good idea to say, everybody stop, let's think about this. And then the city council will take it from there, whether they want to approve the full amount, they can.
They cannot go above what we recommend. They can go below, but they cannot allocate more. So if we were to say 110, they could not go for the full.
Another option to consider is funding $200,000 with tying it to the utility arc, which was the original proposal, which was the overage that's related to the park grant, where we kind of got money that was immediately taken away that we had to reimburse. And so that's that, and then they would need, if they need to spend on the overage for the other larger project, we have to come in either with expedited or not, or they can make the pitch to city council and get $200,000 to use for something else, and that decision isn't up to us, and it's up to council to do it differently.
We have to remember the $200,000 didn't all anyway. I mean, they asked for $425,000. They'll be back in again in the spring. So when you say, I mean, they'll be back before, you know, the bills are ongoing. So I'm kind of leaning with Dave to say $120,000 is more than that's $11,000 more than the estimated cost right now for the utilities. And as that big construction project comes through, then it does mean you have to come in and say what happened to go over. So I feel like we will see them again. By definition, we will, because we've only given them a portion of what they asked for.
Yeah, I mean, one way of looking at it is that we're giving Jim a tool to control costs and to handle the contractors, because our
he'll look at it that way.
I think he would look at it. I mean, because you know, our decisions are public record, and if we go on record of approving 200, the contractors are aware of that immediately. And if I were in the contractor's shoes, I would find all kinds of expenses that suddenly popped up. I mean, they're in business, and they knew that there were going to be contingencies, and they have budgeted for that as part of their bid. Otherwise, they would make no money, and they'd be out of business. So they have to shoulder some of the responsibilities here, too, and not just, I mean, we can't just be shoveling money at the contractors after they come in with a big bid against other contractors, and now it turns out that they should have bid $200,000 more on this contract in order to cover, make it a real contract. And so it looks like they had bid artificially low if work has just started and they already are at $200,000 in the hole. And that doesn't look like a good bid to me.
Well, I think there were never bids from the utilities.
What? Sorry?
There were never bids that came in from the utilities.
Well, where did the...
Jim estimated. It was a total estimate on Jim's part. So it is a little different. And no one anticipated the National Grid would double their effing.
Was that the Verizon charge that we're particularly talking about?
National Grid and Verizon and Comcast and all of those utility charges.
I don't mean to overstate the case, but I do think that us having a reputation as being bankers with sharp pencils and green eye shades is not a bad thing to have, because it means that the contractors will, and even whoever is the estimator with the utilities, because they're trying to make money in this too, will see that there is not money flowing on or growing on trees here.
I think the utilities won't care at all. They're just gonna they're just gonna do what they're gonna do, and I have. Getting the sense of the committee is to reduce the amount. The only last thing I would say is, if you're sort of inviting the city to come back, if there's cost overruns, that's sending out the wrong message too. I'd rather say this is it. You can come to us for phase two, but this is it on phase one. Ain't no more money. Period.
Good thought. Yeah.
Jack.
Yeah, I agree. I think that we should fund the $200,000, the full amount that, well, that's not even the full amount that they requested before. They were coming in with $425,000. We've already taken the step of saying, no, let's go at this at a reasonable pace. So we've already set that limit. But to have a quality park, you need to have the resources, you need to have the contingency just to pay your bills on time so everything goes smoothly. So I think with a project of this size, I think it's just part of the game to have the money there and be able to take care of overruns. You start digging in the ground, you don't know what you're going to find. There's always going to be some increases, and I think this adds to the project, and you know, I don't think there's any doubt that we're not carefully husbanding the money and making sure the allocations go. We spent a lot of time looking at this and supervising it. So I would vote for the full amount and allowing for the contingencies as he requested.
I have a compromise. So why don't we propose $170,000 and fund the set clock? Because that's a tangible thing. It is for the park. It is less than the contingency requested, but it gives him plenty of wiggle room until we'll see him again if we have to. It's just an idea.
So no one is for increasing the allocation over $200,000. No one is for having it less than 120, correct, was the figure that, so we're hearing 100, or I'm hearing 120, 170, and 200, with a condition, which is that it has to go toward underground utilities. Without that condition, underground utilities or construction expenses. So now there are a number of different proposals. We can And we have a formal motion, which is the 400 and whatever it is, what's the total? 459 that's on the floor. That would not change that, it would simply reallocate that. If Devin's proposal went through, we'd be adding the Seth Thomas clock. If we stayed with 200 without the Seth without the clock, we went down to 120, we'd be reducing that 459 by 80,000. So how do we wish to proceed?
How much was the clock? 30?
30.
And we are proposing to...
The clock is not in our shopping cart.
Not in our shopping cart?
Not at the moment.
Okay. I would like to see it in the shopping cart.
I would like to reserve this until we get to the Seth Thomas clock.
Okay.
I appreciate your willingness to compromise.
Okay, so there's competing motions on the non-motions. How about we put off the clock? Is that okay?
Yes.
That's all right. Further discussion on the Pulaski thing. So 200, 120, condition, no condition. Straw votes, are we allowed to do that? Would that make sense in this case? So this is, so is there a straw vote? Do we need to be formal about that? No. So how about I just do the straw vote that we would go with the 200,000 and with Jim's change of condition, the underground utility work or other construction expenses used for construction at Pulaski Park. So we're eliminating it just for the underground utility. So the 200,000 that we have in the shopping cart and keeping Jim's flexibility. All those that would be in favor of that? Okay, all those that would be opposed? Two, and abstaining?
Well, I'd be opposed.
So was that five to, how many of us are there? 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 5 to 3 on that. So do we do a straw vote on the other one too? How do we do this? Okay, so 120, well, let's go with 200,000 just for utility work and not for the broad ability of Jim to use for construction of Pulaski Park. So 200,000 just for utility work. All in favor? All opposed? We know what we're voting on, David?
I'm being quite here. No.
Okay, so back to 200,000, the full amount. Yeah. This is just a straw vote.
Okay.
But with not agreeing to Jim's more flexible condition.
Not agreeing.
So just for siting utilities underground. Got it? So 200,000 just for underground utility work. All those in favor?
Of the 200,000 just for utility.
Correct. All those opposed? Okay, so that's another 3 to 5, that one goes down. Okay. So are we following this?
Mm-hmm.
The sense of the committee. 120,000. So we're going to drop it down to 120,000, which essentially eliminates the ability of the city to have any contingency fund at all. So should we do that 120 with Jim's condition? The underground. Is this the right way to go? Yeah. I don't know how else to do it, right? Mm-hmm. So 120,000 with underground utility work or other construction expenses.
Oh.
All those that be in favor of that, hands up. All those opposed? Okay, that one's going down. 120 just for underground utility work. All those in favor of that, hands up. All those opposed? Okay, so we have a good sense. Correct. We're still a little split, but it looks like we would be voting if we stayed 5 to 3 on keeping in the shopping cart the 200,000 with Jim's proposal to expand the condition from not just utility work but other construction expenses. Is that correct? And we could perhaps revisit this at 11:30 tonight. So, they moved the clock too, isn't that weird? Yeah.
Okay, should we move on and then we'll come back at the end? Does that make sense? And we're pretty much have a sense. Well, I think we have a, pretty much have a sense of what it is. And, okay. Number four, Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area. Remember, they asked for 40. It's down to 30. We had agreed for that. Any additional? We're not voting. We're just
recognizing.
Oh, I'm recognizing.
I'd like to take it back to 40. I think they had a really nice type proposal. I think it's a very.
Well, remember they asked for 30. They got the additional 10. Yeah. Remember that?
And they got 10.
They got 10 more.
I forgot that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So we're not, we're giving them exactly what they want.
Yeah, thank you. That's what I wanted to do.
So 30, we're pretty good on that. Yes? Okay, Historic Northampton, we agreed for full funding for both houses at $131,310. We saw the thing come in from the from Historic Northampton giving us a cost estimate on the barn. Is there a discussion on this? I'm going to make an assumption. We do not want to go under 131,000. Is that correct? We're all in favor of the 2,000. So the question now would be, would we want to do the barn or a portion of the barn?
And the portion being the new revised 153,000.
Could be.
Or even some part thereof.
Or some part thereof, or we could even add, if we, in fact we wanted the handicap bathroom at another 17,100.
I'd make a motion to fully fund the barn and the handicap bathroom.
So I guess we're not doing formal motions now.
Oh, okay.
Because we're still in the shopping cart mode of fumbling our way through this.
Well, I'm in favor. You know, there was so much support for the whole project. There were so many different people. It had the most support of any project, so. And like the builder said, Thompson, he said, it's more cost effective to do the whole project at one time. Rather than going back in to do a handicap bathroom. The handicap bathroom is probably the only handicap bathroom there, probably the most accessible handicap bathroom. Would be in the barn, the easiest to get to.
So if in fact, Marlene, we did that, we'd be adding 17,100 to get us to 170,686. Mm-hmm. Further discussion on the barn?
Quick question, Marlene, I'm sorry.
No, you can.
What, how much more money do we have actually by latest estimate than we thought we had?
Sarah?
200-ish
in
the high amount, I think.
So if in fact we did this, does someone have a calculator?
She said
200-ish. Let's just look real
200.
Quick.
Yeah, I overwrote the estimate, but it's about 200,000.
I mean, even instead of the stock market, I recognize how this looks like the beach because we've allocated this money for the other two houses. I'm also mindful of, though, at the same time, of how the work that's being proposed is not to expand on the existing building, but simply to preserve them from demolition by neglect. They were so badly handled, and there was so little money then to work on them in the past that they have suffered greatly. And I'm pleased to see the reduction in anticipated costs on this new budget that they've come up with. I'm aware of how much free work Nancy has given to this project, and the very low price that Chris Thompson had quoted in his work here, and the amount of time that he's contributed. So even though I agree timing wise, it may seem like we're putting a lot in, I also think that this is, that there may be an issue of needing to do it right now because of the advanced state of deterioration that has occurred, and also taking advantage of the current wealth of volunteers, sweat equity that is being put into this project. I don't know how long this remarkable revival process is going to occur, how long Nancy can stand coming out and driving out from Danvers and doing all that she does for us. But there is no, this is Northampton's key and most important historical society. It does what the, it's much more important in the minds of the public than the historical commission is, because it has exhibitions and buildings on the ground. So it's a wonderful asset. If there is some way to fund it, it seems like, you know, $153,000 for the amount of work that's been proposed seems like it's a good price to me. Even though I agree, it is coming quickly on the heels of the other two projects, but it's kind of emergency work.
So if we were to fund this, it would bring us out of the 460 up to 610 or something. It would drop us down from 782. Next round is somewhere around the same, 610 or something. So fully funding without funding anything else, simply adding the barn to our shopping cart would mean we'd be somewhat evenly split for this round.
But we started the night with Linda's debt story. We have to service the debt out of some of
it. No, this is still all the debt service is included in Sarah's.
Okay.
Stuff. That's all. If we look at it, it's all taken out. Our debt service, $217,000, is subtracted from it.
Okay. Yeah, it's not. So we were. I wrote over the number that was our maximum estimated amount, but it was
1,153,655. Is my note
from last time. So we have about 100,000 more than we anticipated that we would on the high side. And more than 200,000 more
on
the low side.
Okay, so we're still talking about the barn. We're in full agreement about the two houses. It is the barn that we are still discussing. Other quick, Linda?
I'm feeling petty, and so you can appeal to my better angels. I thought we sort of were offering to provide some assistance and for the barn and looking for help in resolving, in working through the timing dilemmas and understanding the priority of things and asking for some help. And I feel like the answer we got back was basically, we need it all.
Yeah, I talked to Nancy on the phone, and her answer was, once we open the door, we have to walk through it. There's no way to do just part of it in this case.
But you're absolutely right, Linda. Our question was, what do we need to keep it from falling down? And this is sort of not the answer that we thought we were going to get. It seems like we're all in or we aren't.
Yeah, and I remember Chris saying that it's necessary to, you just can't do a part of it. And that's why he goes in these paragraphs underneath the money chart describing he has to take soil out, that once you open up certain portions, you have to, and because of the archaeological requirement, the soil has to be taken out. And he just adds, the bathroom is the only thing that doesn't have to be done once you open it up, but it's more efficient to do it at that time. I understand what they're saying, but I remember he said that on the first day, that it's all or nothing with the barn. You can't just do a couple of posts.
Ted?
Well, I'm feeling towards you. I don't feel that you're being petty at all. I think we resolve to balance the fact that the organization has been in financial straits and does not have necessarily adequate reserves now, so it's hard to put all the eggs in the basket to do something that's reasonable. And we asked them, what are your priorities? And they said, the barn is not that much trouble. Like, it will last there anything we can do specifically with the joists without having to do any archaeological digging? And I agree that we didn't get an answer that we were expecting. It might be the right answer, but if that's the answer they're giving us, then I think we're forced to revisit that initial decision. Have our minds changed about either having additional money and feeling willing to do it balanced against what our rationale was last time for saying we're giving you two-thirds of what you're asking for? And I'm not sure that I've been pushed over the edge as much as I like it, and I want to, and I came prepared to think about it and do that with them. I just don't know. It's a lot of work for them to do. It's a three-year period, and they've got two houses, and we've given them money for the prior two houses, and it would be great to get those complete and see where they go. It'll give them time to do their fundraising, build their membership, get some programming in there, and they're still out to the large. That's not part of that. Something that they have acknowledged doesn't need to be done right now.
That makes sense.
Other discussion about the barn? How about a straw?
I'm sorry, I have a comment. So it looks like they came back with their revised budget with a $38,000 savings, and I guess I do wonder, we've had this conversation before, 3 years from now, will inflation have just pushed it up $38,000?
We're going to see the barn now or later.
Yeah. So I'm not, you know, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm impressed that they got such a different price. And I also am concerned to put so much into an organization that is freshly out of the hole, as much as I love this project. So I feel like I could be swayed, but I'm not entirely swayed yet.
Who would like to sway us?
I'll give it a try. I like the barn project, and I think we've got more money, and I think we ought to do it, because I think we will. If we don't do it now, we'll do it later. And I think it will cost more later. And I agree, the organization is tentative, but improving. And I think there is right now some energy there that we ought to get behind. And then I think that will help with the fundraising for them. So I view it as somewhat investing in their future to try to get more people involved. I think the barn's one of the more interesting buildings there, but then I've said that repeatedly.
You know, they had so many people that they just had too many people that came to support it. It was just repetitive. So there was a huge amount of support, and it was the biggest, the largest amount of people showed up for that project.
Well, that's testimony to their director getting people to come.
Yeah.
Keep in mind that Devin dragged a friggin' barn from North Carolina. All the way up here, so her opinion should be
full disclosure,
transparent. I thought our discussion was about their coming back in the next round, that they weren't really going to be able to complete more than the two house projects between now and then anyway. I think that would give us a chance to see whether Nancy's going to stick it out, and if she's not there, I do have concerns about what's going to happen, and whether everything is gelled enough. But I'd be pretty favorably inclined if things were still looking good and they came back in the next round and applied again.
Other discussion?
I'm not looking to put it off a long time.
I could go with that. I mean, but that's the money we know is earmarked. I mean, that's
essentially. We got the park, and we got, if they get funded, and we've got this.
Yep. I am concerned. Can you all tell me your opinions on whether you think they can manage all three projects at the same time? Is it the same people they're working with?
Same contractor.
Correct. It's
Chris.
Chris, correct. Chris is doing all three projects. Yes.
I guess the question is, one man and his helper, can they do work on three buildings at the same time?
You can't do the archaeology in the winter anyway.
In addition to the work that we're doing from the previous grantees project.
Well, in testimony to how much I like barns, let me say that one will be standing next year, I think.
So, Can we do a straw vote on whether to increase the allocation either by 153 or 170 if we want to fund the handicap bathroom as well? Let's go with 153, which is sort of their revised. Can we do that first? Yes? And we'll know what little straw vote here?
On 153, yeah.
153, all those in favor? All those opposed? Abstaining? Nope, opposing?
Yeah.
So that's 2-6.
But you voted for the 153 only.
Correct.
Are you going to vote on 170?
Sure. Okay. 170, which includes the handicap bathroom. All those in favor? All those opposed? And an abstention, is all those abstaining?
I'm abstaining,
okay. So it looks like in both votes we are falling short of approving the barn of straw votes, yeah? Okay. So moving right along, if we can, it's not too bad. What time is it, 9:30?
Yeah,
no, it's not too bad. So we voted for nothing for the historic curtains and the fire curtain thing at the Academy of Music. We were confused as to the priorities and we wanted a little more information on that. Does anyone want to entertain, given our additional funding, to reconsider? Going once? Going twice, gone. The Seth Thomas clock restoration. We voted to not do that. Is any interest in reconsidering that? A couple folks, David? Three folks. David, you want to speak
to that? Yeah, I think the clock is a well-known and very popular piece of Northampton history that has captured the imagination of many town people. Its relocation and reemergence in the Pulaski Park is appropriate and should be contemporaneous with the park's development. Historical items and storage are always in questionable states of preservation. But finishing it up, preserving it, and making it operational and installing it, I think would be a very appropriate thing to do with that clock. And again, the cost is only going to rise. And I think we now also have money to do that because of earlier votes.
Linda?
What he said.
Deb?
Ditto.
Brian? Ditto. Straw vote on this. So there's a straw motion to increase.
Discussion?
Oh, I'm sorry. We're still having a discussion. Sorry.
Are we having a discussion afterwards? So?
No, we're having a discussion now.
Do you have their proposal available to figure out what remains to be done? Is it restoration and installation?
Yes.
Do they have a timeline? Is it going to be ready? I'm wondering whether it actually is going to be ready for when the Pulaski Park opens.
I asked Wayne about that. It's not in the application, but I asked him and he said it should be. It does have to go out to bid. And it depends how fast the particular contractors can work. But he said if it doesn't get funded, animals.
I'm not anticipating that it's going to be up and operational on the day that the ribbon cutting on the park. It might be, might not be, but basically we're trying to sort of get it roughly contemporaneous, and I think if we don't support it now, that puts it off by another, 6 months to a year.
I'd support it too.
So I was swayed last time with the discussion of by delaying and not funding in this round that this alleged fundraising could actually start to happen and we could see that public support come into play instead of being told it's going to happen and then actually funding it all so there's no need for it. So I don't know if that will really happen or not, and I don't think I would vote against it in the next round if it came back, because if we didn't manage, although it looks like we're leaning as a committee towards funding it this time. And I think the other part was that, you know, the park isn't necessarily going to be done on schedule. Certainly isn't on schedule right now, so. But the urgency around this isn't really there, and by having them come back next round, it actually gives them, the planning department, a number of months to follow through on their proposal to fundraise and have more community support of restoring this clock.
Tony, was there a proposal to fundraise for?
There's $5,000 that in the proposal that was going to be raised some other way, so we would be funding 30 and
the project is 35.
Is 35.
Oh, so that's what that additional funds, 5,000, were yet to be come in.
I know there's a prior purchase price of $20,000 or $30,000, higher transportation and storage costs of $10,000. So for like a $70,000 or $80,000 project, it would be nice for something that is allegedly so publicly supported for a park that we have with no public contributions other than ours and our tax money. It would be nice to have some input, and that's why I feel like the burden is on Wayne. If he's gonna, you know, ask him in all the prior rounds, what priority is this compared to all your other projects, and it's always come out at the bottom. It's not the number one priority. It wasn't this round compared to the other things that he submitted. So I would like to see that. If he can't raise the money, explain to us why he can't. And then, you know, you can, I won't be here to object next round to any of this. I don't see that. I mean, it would be nice if it was there with the park, but there were lots of elements of the park that we all liked that got jettisoned when it was cost saving that aren't going to be in the park. And it's not clear when the park is truly going to be ready or if we're going to have more overrun. To me, not the most convincing of the projects that are here. I'd like to see the true support for it from the public.
And the true support is $5,000?
No, I think it would be the balance that was there. I'd like to see a true campaign, an outreach campaign, not an anonymous contribution. Would people actually rally around the fountain? It's a great opportunity for us to come together over our park and one resource that's there that people can appreciate. The only contribution we have is $500 from someone from DPW to wind it each year. That's all that's important.
I'd like to take this last opportunity to disagree with Dave. I maybe there were representations made about getting public funding, but I feel like the staff has a whole heck of a lot of things on their plate, and things that they do very valuably for the city, and asking them to also do a fundraising campaign, it's like, that's not what they should be doing. They got other skills, they got other...
I'm not necessarily asking staff to do it. I'm asking our public community, which is supposedly in favor of the
project. But how is that going to happen?
We've got historic commission, we've got Northampton historic, we've got all the partners, the value, its historic significance, and all the people.
And this is part of the statute, too. Isn't it part of the Community Preservation Act that there'd be fundraising? And it's sort of, we've lost sight of that. I remember one of the big projects was the Bean Farm, and the fundraising was phenomenal. I haven't seen anything close to that. So many projects just come in and ask for the money and don't bother with the fundraising. So I think it's a good point to bring up. But fundraising is part of this whole statute. It's in the statute.
It's not.
It's not in the statute. Well, I think
it's part of our plan that it's encouraged, but it's definitely not required as part of the statute.
Well, I think maybe it was interpreted from the public support, which is in the statute. To show public support, how do you do that? You come in here, or you can do fundraising. I think public support has been interpreted as fundraising. And that is how it gets in the plan. I don't think, the people who wrote the plan just came up with, their own ideas about fundraising. But
I suppose a compromise would be to fund half of it contingent on the rest being privately funded.
I feel strongly, it's a modest project, it's $30,000, and I feel strongly we just need to get it done. And we've got the money for it, and the project is, I don't know whether it'll be done before or after the park, but it's a popular, very popular thing. I've heard people make comments about the clock many times over the years in the Gazette and otherwise, and I've never heard anything negative about it, and I think it'll be delightful. For many people in the town to see it up again. It's finite. It's going to be, the city will take care of its maintenance and operation. And the idea of dribbling along with half payment on installation after we've gone to this extent of acquiring it and storing it, and we have a place that's going to be set aside for it, we'll just want to get it done. We've got the money for it.
Are we ready for a straw vote on this? So, to fully fund, which is $30,000 for the Seth Thomas clock, that would then add, throw it into our shopping cart, and that would be $459,679, and reduce our next budget to $750,000. So the additional 30 now, less 30 for next round. You know what we're voting for? $30,000 for Seth Thomas. All those in favor? All those opposed? So that's a 5-3 in favor. Is that correct? Yeah. Last but not least, the Mineral Hills invasives removal. That was, remember, in our short-term projects, but we bumped it up here to get additional stuff. We threw it in our shopping cart, fully funded at 3. Does anyone want to take it out of the shopping cart? Yes?
Did we have the discussion about using the pesticides? We did have that discussion, didn't we?
You've done it in a very, very careful manner.
Yeah.
Not to spread it unnecessarily.
Okay. Herbicides, not pesticides.
Okay. All right, I just had forgotten.
Oh, that's a good concern.
Yeah.
But they're very, very careful with it, yeah. Otherwise, you get the phragmites all over the place. We need those tall weeds, and they take over and they kill all the other local plants.
So we're good with keeping that in?
Yeah. Yes.
So our shopping cart now has been changed with the 30,000 addition of the clock to bring us up to $489,310. Before we vote, do we want to look at conditions and then put this all in a package? Does that make sense?
Well, I put together a draft resolution. It may make sense to refer to those. There isn't one for the clock because it wasn't funded for a weekend.
Okay. So I think it makes sense rather than voting, or we could entertain a motion to vote on this and then come back to conditions. What makes sense? Would like to do that?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so is there a motion?
Clarification?
Yes.
The amount we're working off of, the total, has also taken out the Lathrop of $3,000 that we previously did.
Correct.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. If you look at the fiscal 16 overview, Sarah did a nice job there of showing what has come out of that, including, of course, the debt service administration and Lathrop as well. So is there a motion on the floor?
I mean, we approved the shopping cart.
Isn't there a motion on the floor?
No, I think.
There is
a motion.
Well, the cart got changed.
The cart got changed. So who made the initial motion? Marlene, is there we'd like to change the initial motion?
Right, yes.
To
$489,310? Yes.
Or we can do the discussion all over again.
Yeah. No,
it
sounds good to me.
Okay, is there a second? And we had a second of the changed motion. Got that, Sarah? For last discussion, I guess, right?
So we took a number of straw polls around the table to get a sense of what people wanted. Did we actually have a memorialized vote on each of those projects so that when it's given to council, stipulate
No, I mean, the motion on the floor is to package these all together.
And that's the $200,000 for Pulaski Park as it sits now.
Yes.
Is included in the $489,000.
Yeah, we right. Without the discussion of the committee.
So we are not voting on each line item by line item. We would be voting on the shopping cart with this proposal. And if people feel strongly against that, then we could go line item by line item.
And we are voting separately on the conditions.
Correct, we're deciding. I'm not sure we vote on conditions, do we? Or, well, I guess we do if we have to. Yeah. So is that upsetting?
Just one, I don't know, from the council's perspective, whether it will be a departure since they...
Is it a departure?
Typically, I've always, when we review the resolutions, that's when issues come up. So I've always used the vote for the resolution. It's whether something is unanimous or not. And if someone didn't like a project at all, they would vote against it at that point.
Right.
Or if they felt strongly about a condition that was included, then they'd vote against it. Right.
In that sense, the individual votes project by project, transmits some information to the council.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they always ask about that.
Would we rather do that? Would we feel more comfortable quickly going, yes, I'm seeing Ed's nodding. Yeah. Linda?
That's fine.
Yeah, Jack?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's begin. Let's go down on our fiscal 16 overview in that order. Is there a motion to fund $90,000 for the Rocky Hill Connector?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? All opposed? Unanimous. Is there a motion to fund $5,000 for the gate for the Connecticut River Greenway Park? I'm putting the condition in, but I guess we shouldn't do that. $5,000 for the Connecticut River Greenway Park.
Yeah,
I should
put in the condition.
Well, I will put the condition in, but I'm not making a proposal. Is there a motion?
What was the condition of the
thousand? So the gate. We'll be voting on all of the projects twice this way. It's because we have to go through and approve the recommendations to council. And we want to move this to a reading of the draft order.
That probably makes sense, doesn't it?
If it's contingent on conditions.
Yes, and it sounds like it is. So can we step back real quick? Do we have any conditions on the Rocky Hill Connector that we want to set? Let me see, where's Rocky Hill Connector? Thank you, Sarah. That makes, right, I want to understand. So we're going back, even though we voted, do we want to add?
The bottom one on my
back. Thank you.
On the fourth whereas clause, where it says if announced, this clause will be removed from the award amount change. I'll take it out when it goes to council if it's not announced.
And so this would include, this now says at the bottom, it has be it ordered and then says, and the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee. Those would be additional conditions.
Yeah, so those are
the contract.
Yeah, so those are things in the contract.
Standard ones. So,
yeah.
we'd only articulate one we would want to alert the council to.
Correct.
Yeah, like for example, with the Lathrop Communities Grant, it was specific in the council order that they need to keep their land open for the public or the term of the project.
What are we doing about signage? Are we adding that? How have we done that with additional open space?
That's generally been done in the MOUs.
Okay. And not
that's required of all CPA projects, isn't it?
Is it?
We have a standard clause in the contracts for all of them. If there's something specific that the committee wants to talk about, then we change it at that point.
So
this sort of broad overview is just kind of keeping council from mining the details.
Enforcement on that, but we happen to have Brian pass judgment on the appropriateness of the signage in each particular case because it's going to vary whether
yeah.
a building or a high rail. But yeah, I think they should, public should know that CPA money has supported a project.
But with that, the question is, does that go into this document?
It never has.
It never has.
It doesn't mean it couldn't. If the committee wanted to include it in the resolution, it could be.
I'd be fine.
So we're saving signage for the MOU. We feel that's okay.
Yeah.
Any additional conditions other than what Sarah has put down? Whereas, so we're sort of revoting on this, or we sort of voted already, but no conditions. Yeah, we can move on. Okay, so Connecticut River Greenway. The condition that I can't find it. Connecticut River Greenway, where are you? Here we go. Okay, so the condition would be, or one possible condition would be that the $5,000 goes specifically to the gate. But we do not say that in this, is that correct?
No, it says it in there. It says for the Connecticut River.
In space across, right, yes. Okay.
Yeah, this one was a pretty clear cut split of what the committee was funding, so I just only referenced the gate and signage on the talk about the paper.
Any additional whereases?
About when we talked about it last time, we had talked about the condition that before they spend the money on the gate, that they have a written, recorded agreement or written agreement with all the parties as to what the use of that gate and access would be. I don't know that we realize it, right? And I can also just go to an MOU, but since I won't be here, looking for the MOU, we found the money to remember that. That's what we went back to reaching.
And we did. That was the confusion. But Sarah, we're thinking that's more for the MOU.
I just forgot about that. So we could certainly add that here.
Is the feeling of the committee that we need that in this to the to City Council, or that we can simply add that to the MOU after?
I would put it in here because that's a big ask. So I would make that clear.
Okay. So how do we state it? Is there language that?
Or if there is an agreement that the involved parties understand each other's use of the gate.
So we want to help wordsmith that one?
Put a binding written agreement on all parties with access.
That's not, I would leave out the binding.
At least suggest either a contract or an official agreement. Written agreement?
Sure.
Can you say it again?
We'll do it together. Written agreement.
Between all the parties, the affected parties, governing access to the use of the gate and access to the site.
Is it governing or agreeing on?
Well, a written agreement that is governing. So a written agreement that's documenting what they've agreed upon.
Or govern. It governs.
Okay. So say it, I'm sorry, say it one more time then.
I can't. It's his job.
Oh, written agreement.
You can do that.
Between all affected parties.
This is where the governing came in.
That governs.
Use of the gate and access to the site.
Perfect. Okay, is there a motion on the table to appropriate $5,000 for this?
I move we approve $5,000 for this with the additional agreement added to what we previously had.
Is there a second?
Before we get to the second, can I just make one minor change to the resolution? Suggest one.
Sure.
In the third whereas clause, Sarah, it says CPA funds will leverage significant public and private funds already invested. I don't think that can happen if it's already been invested. It's So you might just say.
Add to?
You could say where significant public and private funds have already been invested in the site, and CPC will increase awareness of the park value of resource. Just switch that around.
Thank you.
And then I second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Linda, was there?
Oh, I'm sorry.
In favor, yes?
Right, in favor.
Okay, unanimous?
No, there's one dissension.
Oh, there was dissension. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. So that's 7-1 on that. My apologies. Number three, Pulaski Park. Pulaski Park. It was the sense of the group, at least in our straw vote, to add that language from Jim, which was, what? I know I wrote down somewhere.
It's in the resolution. So it's now therefore be it ordered. So I thought that it wasn't really a whereas, it's kind of what we're spending the money on. So the $200,000 be appropriated from CPA funding to the Public Works Commission for additional funding for Plastic Park Renovation Project. And then Jim's language, for underground utility work or other construction expenses related to construction of the Pulaski Park.
Great. Thank you, Sarah.
Is this clear that it can only be used for phase one?
The utilities are kind of...
No, but if it's... Going
it
for
says the last whereas says phase one.
Okay.
Phase one of the project.
Okay.
Any additional whereases or therefores on this?
So that's not the language that Jim recommended. It has the effect of not limiting how it's used for phase one. But if we're...
Okay. So I suggested other language to him, and he said it was fine. And I like mine better. No,
I thought it got clearer between them and that.
So it doesn't matter that we're talking about the contingents anymore?
He wanted to make it clear in the resolution that there was the freedom to not just use it on utility work.
Write it down from my notes are the exact same.
I think he read my email once and then another time he didn't. But either way, it's the same. If you like the language, equally as much.
There is to be no yawning in your last meeting. Any other whereases or therefores?
Got a question. On this, the last paragraph says that the city anticipates that $144,000 is going to come from the open space reserve. If it's coming from a reserve account, why are we having to withdraw it?
So we draw down reserve accounts first, because that's our 10% set aside. So when we have a project that is in an open space or recreation category, I just picked this one because it was the biggest one. Yeah, so I emptied out that reserve account, so it's zeroed out for the rest of the year.
So Sarah, should that read 148,000?
No. So the reserve accounts are set by a vote of the Community Preservation Committee and City Council. We went to both bodies with the 145,000. The extra 3,000 has to be spent this year on those projects. But it's not actually physically in that reserve account.
Okay. I think we had a motion on the floor, and then David, you asked something else. So, Devin, are you the one that made the motion? No. Did we have a motion on this? No. Okay. Let's start again. Is there a motion to appropriate $200,000 with the conditions? Or whereas is in there for, is it as noted?
Yes, so moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? So that is our 5-3. Duly noted, Sarah? Okay, moving on to...
So the explanation to council, because I know they'll ask why that was 5-3, is it because you didn't agree with the flexibility of the spending, or should I not address it?
From my perspective, it was because that was, it was speculative spending.
To fund the contingency as well.
What?
Funding the contingency was...
Funding it at that level involves a significant amount of speculative or expenditure that has not been documented and is only being put aside as a reserve fund. And that discussion also occurred of funding the request at the 170 level. So in my case, opposing the 200 was not opposing any funding, but funding closer to known expenses.
Tony, something to add?
I agree with that. I don't like this language, other construction expenses, it takes it out of contingency. I don't know how this is tracked, and I don't know why there was never contingency, but this just seems to open it really wide. So, generally, what Dave said.
Dave?
I'm not sure it's appropriate to be saying why people did or didn't. It's not our regular practice. Marlene, when she objected, didn't get an opportunity to weigh in. I mean,
that's good.
The voting committee, it's incumbent upon our chair, if you go to talk about the types of discussion that we had, but it's how, and the people who voted yes don't get an opportunity to say why they voted yes. So I object to this line of question. I appreciate it. I think it's going to come up, and we're going to be prepared if you go. But
I'll just summarize the discussion.
I think there are lots of reasons that go into why we make others that aren't easily articulated.
Okay, so we are moving right along, correct?
Yep.
Where are we? The Sterling Lake Conservation Area? Is that right? I think so. Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, looking at the... looking at the conditions set for. Any additional stuff? Do I have a chance to look at it?
I move we approve $30,000 for Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area with conditions as stated.
Second. All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay. Moving right along to historic Northampton. So a chance to quickly look at the whereases. The motion is to fund $131,310 for the, with the conditions set forward, which are Damon and Shepherd House.
Sorry, I'll look at that. Make a suggestion as to the whereas.
Yeah, we'll do it. Let's do it now.
The first whereas only talks about Damon and Shepherd Houses, and I feel like it would be worthwhile to mention that they requested the money for the barn, and then in our order, clear that we only suggested that we only funded two of the three.
So to restore, renovate, stabilize the Damon Shepherd houses and the, what's the barn called?
That would be different than some of the already approved.
Okay. I withdraw. I just feel like we should communicate with the full asking so that they have the contact cards.
And we could do all of that in a cover letter as well.
Is there a way to structure the vote so that those of us, singular that we are, support the barn restoration, don't seem to be voting against the $131,000 for the housing. Can we break that vote into two?
You could make a motion now.
Can we vote what?
You could make a motion to that effect.
Can I ask for the motion to include that? You broke it into two.
Okay, so the first motion would be $131,000 plus the $153,000, is that correct?
Well, one motion for the $131,000, one motion for the $153,000.
Is that appropriate? Okay, so we're first voting for the $131,000 because that's the motion on the floor.
For the two houses, yeah.
For the two houses. Marlene made it. We did not have a second.
Second.
So all those in favor, $131,310 for Damon and Shepherd. And raise your hands, please. Unanimous. Is there a second motion regarding historic Northampton?
I'd like to move that the committee approve $153,586 to support the stabilization of the historic barn.
The second motion.
And is there discussion on that?
If I were funding this right now, I would lump that bathroom right in there because I think it's worth it.
Yeah.
I would add the bathroom.
Yeah. I amend my motion to include the bathroom.
I think they made the motion.
So the motion is amended to include the additional $17,100.
So 170.
You need a larger number.
170,686.
586.
Correct?
175.86.
No, 176.86.
Oh, I'm sorry, I missed the one.
And the second came in with Marlene, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Do we need further discussion on this? I can't remember how I voted the first time. Seriously.
You can do whatever you want the second time.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay, so the motion does not carry 3-5.
Could I ask the secretary to poll the opposed votes as to why they voted incorrectly? I mean, we'll vote as they did.
I think holding back and waiting too much at once, instability in administration and management, concerns over direction. But did other people want to chime in on that? No? Okay, let's move it right along. So let's see, Historic Curtains Academy of Music. Is that where we are? Yes. Is there a motion on the table to not fund?
Motion to not fund.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor of funding zero amount for the Academy of Music. All those opposed? It is unanimous. Seth Thomas Clock Restoration. We don't have a condition list there.
So yes, I can use the previous council order as a template. And the conditions there are the clock or any, and it doesn't really matter because they've already been approved by council. The clock or any of its components shall not be disposed of without city council approval. The clock will be ultimately be installed at a highly visible public downtown location, at which point a permanent historic preservation will be created. And then, one that Wayne didn't get to yet, the Office of Planning and Sustainability will conduct a fundraising campaign for the clock's repair, which was intentionally vague by the community.
Any additional conditions on that?
Do we want to say that it's
be used in that Pulaski Park?
Sarah, is that, can you get that in there?
So just change highly visible to Pulaski Park?
I mean, that's what we've been, why we're supporting it, really.
Correct. Yes, wise, whereas. Any other things to add there? Okay, is there a motion to appropriate $30,000 for the Seth Thomas clock?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those, further discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? So 6-2 on that. Do we need, since we've been doing this, we might as well continue. Do we want the two negatives to quickly state why?
It's out of order.
Oh, we just did it.
We're on the record.
Okay. Last, but certainly not least, is Mineral Hills Invasive Removal for $3,000 for that. Is there a, let's look at the conditions.
What was that one? Sorry.
We are looking at the whereases and the therefore on the Mineral Hills brushland restoration thing.
I'd like to move to approve the 50,000 with the suggested clarification of the third whereas on it, since Wayne and company were not specific as to how the parcel would be used. I don't feel comfortable saying that it will create habitat for endangered species, because it may not. So I would suggest the project will create habitat that may be suitable for endangered species or potentially be restored for agricultural purposes.
Is that good with folks?
Sure.
Yes? Anything else? Any other whereases? Yes, no. Okay, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? I think we are done. Is that correct?
Let's do adjourn.
No, I will not accept a move to adjourn before I make two final comments, if I may. Or you have to listen anyway.
We have to do the MOU for later.
That's one of them. So where is that? Did that come to us?
Yeah.
Are we looking at it somewhere?
Do you have paper copies?
I do not.
Okay. I'm having a problem with the internet.
Somehow I was surprised.
Yeah. I really learned how to twerk.
Oh, yes. Okay, so hopefully some of us have it in front of us, which is a memorandum of agreement for the invasive removal project at Lathrop. Really, the condition that we added was the public access one. The grantee, if you don't have it in front of you, the grantee shall continue to provide public access to the trails on its property for the term of this agreement.
And that's really the only thing that's different.
Is there a motion to accept as written?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? It is unanimous. All right. Yeah, David.
I don't be real anxious to leave, but I wanted to say thank you to everybody for making this a really wonderful experience. And though we may disagree, we often agree. And what I valued most was the fact that your opinions helped form mine, and that of all the committees, this is probably the most deliberative and thoughtful. And I know that we don't always achieve the outcome that our applicants want, but I feel like we have a responsibility to really contribute to the CPA, and we do a pretty darn good job. And it's been educational and eye-opening and wonderful all the way through, even though we've some challenges. Those help us be better, so thanks everybody.
Arlene, anything? Ditto?
Ditto, but I also, it's been really a very good experience for me. I met a lot of really interesting people, a lot of hardworking people, and I can't believe how much time so many of you spend working for the city, especially Devin. Every time I go, she's there. But it is really important to safeguard these funds, so it's an important job. And I'll get to all you.
Thank you both.
Yes, thank you.
Brian, may I check in? It should be brief, but I just, we recently, and after great debate and discussion, funded a couple of fair housing projects on Pleasant Street. I just wanted to check in to see if they're on schedule, if our interest is being maintained. And
So the lumber yard did not get funded in the most recent round of affordable housing tax credits, which isn't all that surprising, but people often don't get funded in the first round. Pleasant Street, the other Pleasant Street project also did not, but CAF has control of that property.
That's the lumber yard?
No, that's
logic.
Sort of have control.
They have site control.
So before we leave, let me remind you that Sarah recently sent us a copy of the community preservation plan. Devin is the only one who has responded. Yay, Devin! So it is up to us to get our comments back. We said by the time Sarah leaves for Belize, which is December 2nd or something. So by the end of the month, hopefully we are reviewing not just our individual sections of expertise, but the entire plan, and getting those to Sarah. We have two meetings planned in January. The first is to review the plan as we have gotten suggestions in, and the second meeting in January would be the open to the community as a mandated public input to the plan. In the thoughts that no one will show us. So just a reminder that we have to do that.
So this is 6th and the 20th, right?
Yep.
Correct. 6th and 20th.
I won't be here for the 6th. And we do have a December meeting?
We do not.
No December meeting. The next time we meet is January?
Correct.
Happy New Year.
Next time we meet is when?
January 6th. January the
6th. Okay. Brian, I won't be here.
You will be missed, as will Marlene. We'll be joined by our three additional members not at that meeting. Correct?
I think they get sworn in maybe today or something.
Okay.
So they may not be.
There has been no motion to adjourn. Sit your ass back.
Well, I do want to note that January 6th is the epiphany, so we are expecting a level of acumen and insight from your leadership.
Excellent. Is there a motion to
return? Second.
Okay. All those opposed.